Good morning, everyone, and welcome to the fourth meeting of the Net Zero Energy and Transport Committee for 2024. The first agenda item is to consideration of whether we take items 3 and 4 in private. Item 3 is to consider the evidence we will hear on the Scottish Budget today, and item 4 is to consider a draft letter on the Scottish Biodiversity Strategy. Do we agree to take these matters in private? We are agreed. We also have a decision on whether to take our work programme in private at our next meeting. Are we happy to do that? We are happy to do that. So we'll move on to agenda item 2, which is an evidence session with the Scottish Government on its proposed budget for the financial year 2024 to 2025. Last week, we heard from both the Deputy First Minister in her capacity as Cabinet Secretary for Finance and the Cabinet Secretary for Wellbeing, Economy, Fair Work and Energy. For this session, I'm very pleased to welcome Murray McCallum, the Cabinet Secretary for Transport, Net Zero and Just Transition, and Murray Goujon, the Cabinet Secretary for Rural Affairs, Land Reform and the Islands, who is attending remotely, and I'm expecting to see her on the screen. Has she joined? Okay. So I expect to see her on the screen shortly. We're also joining her is Anna Densham, the Deputy Director for Land Reform, Rural and Island Policy, Scottish Government, Simon Fuller, the Deputy Director for Rural and Environmental Science and Analytical Services from the Scottish Government, Philip Raines, the Deputy Director for Domestic Climate Change for the Scottish Government, Brendan Callaghan, the Head of Operational Delivery for Scottish Forestry, and Kerry Twyman, the Director of Finance and Corporate Services. Thank you for joining us this morning. I'd also like to welcome Graham Simpson, MSP, who's joined us for this session. I'll ask you, offer you the chance to ask one or two questions nearer the end of the session. As you'll be aware, Cabinet Secretaries, I think I can refer to you in the plural, although I can't see Mary Goujon. The way we propose to run this session is to initially put questions to both of you on areas where you have a joint interest. We will then suspend briefly before we take further evidence from Murray McCallum on matters specifically within her ministerial portfolio. I expect the latter session to be the longer of the two. Before we move on to questions, I would like to offer both Cabinet Secretaries the chance to make a brief opening statement. And Murray McCallum, do you want to head off first?
Yes, of course, Convener. Thank you. Good morning, and thank you for inviting me to give evidence on my portfolio budget for 24-25. As you will have heard from a number of my colleagues now, this budget has been developed in extremely difficult financial circumstances. The spending decisions of the UK government mean that our block grant has fallen in real terms by 1.2% since 22-23, despite record inflation. Capital funding is due to contract by almost 10% in real terms, something which is of particular concern to me, given that my portfolio carries roughly 40% of the Scottish Government's capital programme. Now, this has required very difficult choices and reprioritisation towards programmes that most effectively deliver on the Government's key outcomes. And to give the committee an overview, this includes spending of nearly £2.5 billion on our public transport system, including investment of over £1.6 billion to maintain, improve and decarbonise Scotland's rail network and extend peak fares removal pilot. We will also invest £430 million to support bus services and their users, providing access to free bus travel for over 2 million people, including all under 22s, with more than 100 million free journeys made since the scheme was launched. We'll continue to invest in walking, wheeling and cycling, allocating £220 million in 24-25, as well as spending £435 million to support our Lifeline ferry services. The safety of our road network has also remained a significant priority, and we are investing record amounts to maintain, adapt and improve our roads and make them all safe for all users. This includes critical work on the A83 Rest and Be Thankful, as well as the A9 Duelling programme, with work to commence on the Tamatin-Tamoy section and procurement of the three remaining southern sections. We are delivering on our commitment to protect our natural environment, halting biodiversity loss through our £65 million Nature Restoration Fund and Scotland's Biodiversity Strategy Delivery Plan, with a further £29 million investment to halt biodiversity loss in the coming year. We've ensured that our environmental regulators are well equipped to deliver the pivotal role they play in maintaining a healthy and safe environment, and are investing almost £40 million in 24-25 to drive Scotland's circular economy, reducing reliance on scarce resources and waste. Convener, that is an overview. Ultimately, despite the real and very, very trying funding constraints that have borne down on this year's budget, this broad and diverse portfolio prioritises tackling the climate emergency and supporting biodiversity whilst delivering a safe, accessible and resilient transport network for the people of Scotland. That's the conclusion of my opening statement, convener. I might, if you don't mind, hand very briefly to my colleague Phil Raines, who's got a technical update for the committee's awareness.
Would that not be appropriate if a question arises relating to it? I mean, that was quite a long opening statement.
I appreciate that, convener, and I don't want to take up any more time than need be. This is about an inaccuracy in the published budget, which I should prefer to bring to the committee's attention.
OK, on that basis, Philip, if you'd like to come in briefly on that.
Thank you, convener, and thank you for forbearance. I'll keep this relatively short. It's come to our late attention, and regrettably, that a handful of the figures within Annex J, which refers to the taxonomy, the net zero taxonomy, something that was discussed last week and indeed may be discussed in this session, were not quite correct. They were based on older figures that were used as part of the budget discussions. They are relatively minor errors, and we will be writing to the committee to correct it and also to correct the official record in terms of the publication as soon as possible. As a matter of urgency, we redid the analysis based on the correct figures to work out whether the overall conclusions that were set out in the Annex J were correct, and we have established that is the case. So, in a sense, the analysis is not affected by it, but however, the figures do need correction. We will be writing to the committee to set that out, and I can only apologise for the errors that cropped into the documentation.
Okay, I'm a little bit confused. When you say relatively minor, are we talking about thousands, hundreds of thousands, or millions?
We are talking about millions within a budget that is billions. So I'm using it in
millions. I'm a little bit concerned by this at this stage to get this, because the committee asked this question last week. I think it was Mark Ruskell was asking about Annex J and the details within it. It now appears that we've based part of our scrutiny on something that is factually incorrect.
We have only discovered this relatively late, and I can assure yourself, and I can assure the rest of the committee, that we have done the analysis to work out whether the overall conclusions made by Annex J, in a sense, the numbers, the things that are set out as part of the conclusions that were drawn within the Annex J are still correct, and the actual numbers within the main budget document are absolutely correct. So it's only a transposing issue, if you will, within Annex J itself. But again, I offer my apologies for that.
Okay, Philip, with respect, it's very easy for you to sit there and make those comments, and until we've had a chance to scrutinise it, we're not in a position to say whether we agree or disagree with you. And I also understand the size of the Scottish budget, and relatively minor to describe millions doesn't quite fall within my category of categorisation of money. So I think the committee will want to reflect on this afterwards and see the Annex J when it's resubmitted, and we may wish to take further evidence on it. That will be up for the committee to decide. So we'll leave that there. So I'm going to go to Marie Goujon and offer you the chance to make a brief opening statement, if you'd like, Marie.
Thank you very much, Convener, and also to the committee members for inviting me to give evidence to you today. My colleague, the Cabinet Secretary for Net Zero, has just mentioned the difficult financial backdrop that we're facing in relation to this budget. And against that, the decisions that we've taken really are driven by our values and prioritise the three missions that we have. Of course, in my portfolio, the impact of Brexit continues to harm Scotland's rural and island businesses and communities, and it also creates new challenges every year for us to respond to. But the budgets that have been allocated to my portfolio are going to continue to make that really vital difference to our rural, coastal and islands economies. As I did for the previous financial year, for this year, I've prioritised the vital direct cash injection of £600 million that my portfolio makes into the economy for rural, agriculture, marine and island communities. And we are now providing the most generous package of direct support for farmers and crofters anywhere in the UK. And we're also committed to getting that money to people and businesses as early as we can every year and to help them meet the ongoing inflationary and cost of living pressures. Now, as the committee will be aware, my portfolio has, of course, expanded to include responsibility for peatland, land reform and land use in forestry and woodlands. And I've committed to maintaining our record world-leading investment in peatland there. Investment in new woodland creation planting will continue to contribute to our climate change targets and net zero ambitions. But as I said at my recent attendance at the Rural Committee, we have set very ambitious planting targets, and the level of funding that we can provide within the budget means that it is going to be extremely difficult for us to meet those. However, we are going to continue to build on the positive work that we've already done, and the planting levels achievable within this budget will continue to exceed other areas of the UK. I've also committed to deliver agri-environment investment, including the Agricultural Transformation Fund, which is part of an overall budget of £30 million. And of course, we also have the Scottish Land Fund, which is going to continue to support many community groups to acquire those assets that will make a difference to them in tackling challenges within their communities. And by maintaining the £14 million budget for Marine Fund Scotland, we are continuing to acknowledge the vital role that our seas play in supporting activity to improve and restore the marine environment, as well as supporting the wider economy in coastal communities through fishing and aquaculture too. Convener, I would just finish by saying that I think I speak for all my Cabinet colleagues to say that this government is committed to doing all that we can with all that we have to support our priorities in rural industries and sectors, both through this as well as through other portfolios. Thank you.
Thank you very much, Cabinet Secretary. And just say, I think some of your officials are here in the room today, so when you're answering questions, I don't know if you'll be in the position where you can see them, but if they indicate they want to come in, I will try and indicate to you they want to come in. It'll be up to you whether you let them come in. That's not a decision I can make, Cabinet Secretary. So the first questions will come from Jackie Dunbar. Jackie.
Thank you, and good morning, Cabinet Secretaries. My first couple of questions is going to be directed to the Cabinet Secretary for Rural Affairs, and it's in regards to the peatland and natural resources. My understanding is that there has been £250 million allocated over 10 years for peatland restoration. £66.7 million of that fund has been allocated over the last 3 years. And according to evidence we took from Nature Scott, £40 million of it has been spent up to and including 2022-23. Can you tell me how much has been spent last year, that is 2023-24?
Yes, no, thank you very much for highlighting that. We do have very ambitious targets when it comes to peatland restoration. So when it comes to the overall budget that we have for peatlands available this year, we have £26.9 million available over the coming financial year, as has been published in the 24-25 budget, which is a 1% increase on the budget that we'd had available last year, which means that we should be able to plant roughly the same levels. So when we look at the approvals that are coming through for the financial year 23-24, we're looking at nearly 10,000 hectares of planting there, which I believe would ensure that we are utilising the available budget.
Okay, sorry, I might have missed it. Did you say the figure for how much it was for last year? Sorry.
Yes, I think it was 26.6 million that we had available in the budget for last year.
And can you tell me what any of the underspends were used for? You know, were they used to help address the barriers for scaling up the peatland restoration, for example?
That has very much been a focus. I think we've had a number of issues when it comes to peatland restoration, really because ultimately it is an industry that's in its infancy. There's been limited contractor availability. It can only take place within a certain window in the year as well. So trying to overcome these challenges, really build up that skills pipeline, has been a key focus as well. So obviously we fund peatland restoration through Peatland Action, which goes to funds five different bodies to take part in that work as well. But that's not the only funding that's available. But I would just say that there has been a big focus on skills there to ensure that we're enabling the growth of the industry to meet the challenges and meet the scale of restoration that we need going forward within that as well. As I said, I touched on in my previous response, just to highlight, I don't know if Simon would want to come in and offer any clarification on the points that I've made, but I believe with the budget that we'd had set out last year and the scale of the restoration that we'd expecting to see and the approvals that we have in the pipeline, I believe that that would utilise the available budget that we have for peatlands, but I don't know if Simon would have any further clarification in relation to that.
Yes, very, very happy to come in. So, as the Cabinet Secretary said, the budget for 23-24 is £26.6 million. Whilst we cannot say definitively at this point in the year how much will be deployed, we'd expect the vast majority of that budget, if not all of it, to be utilised during this year. And as the member said, there have been underspends in previous years. They have come down year on year as the pipeline of projects has increased, as contractor capacity has increased, and so on. And so, as a result, the budget is being fully utilised now.
Okay, thank you. Convener, I'm finding it a bit difficult to hear people today. I don't know if it's my ears or if it's the microphones.
No,
it's slightly muffled.
I am in agreement. I'm Murray. Goujon, it's quite slightly difficult for me to hear. Philip, if you just swing your microphone round in case you're about to speak, and that at some stage that would be helpful. I don't know if on the sound thing we can try.
Could just be me.
He will do what he can, is the answer. Jackie, do you have any further questions?
Yes, sorry about that. Cabinet Secretary, as you said, natural resources and peatlands are within your portfolio. And I understand what peatlands are, but can you maybe expand on what is meant by natural resources?
Yes, the natural resources part of the portfolio helps to fund areas such as wildlife management and biodiversity and those other parts within that as well. Again, Simon could probably elaborate on further information within that specific budget line, but that's largely what that covers.
Okay.
Yes, happy to add some further points on that. So, as the Cabinet Secretary says, the natural resources budget line is quite diverse. It covers a large number of wildlife management policies. It also covers elements on biodiversity and also Atlantic rainforest restoration. That would be the third key element.
Okay, thank you. And I noticed that the budget for that has been reduced to £4.5 million this year. Can you tell me what impact that's going to have?
Yes, that's actually largely been due to the more accurately reflect the spend with that, within that element. As Simon Fuller has just outlined, and of course the key point that I forgot to mention is in terms of the Atlantic rainforest, where we're continuing that investment. But parts of that budget have been underspent in the past. So what we see set out in the published budget more accurately reflects what the spend will be within that area.
OK, thank you. That's all I have just now, Convener.
Thank you, Jackie. Just before we leave this subject, I wonder if I could just check with the Cabinet Secretary. I think your indication is that the money will be spent, the £250 million will be spent at the end of the 10-year period. Will we have achieved all the restoration that was programmed for spending that £250 million, or will the money be gone and we won't have reached the target?
Well, I certainly hope that, and I'm certainly doing, and we're trying to do everything we can to ensure that we meet that target. I mean, of course, when you look at the restoration rates over the past few years, up until, well, 2021 anyway, the average restoration that we would be seeing was about 1,500 hectares. Then from 2021 upwards, we really have seen big increases in the level of restoration. And I think that goes back to the point that I was making in response to a previous question about us trying to scale up the industry, which is still in its infancy. So after 2020, we've seen restoration rates increase from to 6,000 hectares. Then I think the 22-23 it was 7,500 hectares, so 35% increase. And then we're on track this year to see that increase further to 10,000 hectares. So I really think we are moving in the right direction when it comes to that. And that's why continuing with this investment is so vital, I think, in providing that confidence for the industry going forward, that we will be continuing that funding so that we can see that industry continue to grow and identify and really try and deal with some of the issues that we've seen in terms of our ability to do that.
Okay, sorry, if I can just drill down into that a wee bit. £66.7 million has been allocated, and during the period we've managed to crack 18,500 hectares on the road to recovery. So when we spent the £250 million, how many hectares of peatland do you think will be recovered, Cabinet Secretary?
Sorry, I think some of the figures that you've said there in relation to that, I don't know if you're including this current year, but that doesn't sound correct to me in terms of what we've already restored. So
I'm only going on the figures that the Scottish Government have given the committee. So I think that those are the figures that we were given. So I'm just asking you, when we've spent the 250 million, how many hectares of peatland will be recovered?
Well, ultimately, the commitment was for £250 million over the course of 10 years to restore 250,000 hectares of degraded peatland. So in relation to that, obviously, it's not possible for me to say at the moment what that's going to look like in 5-6 years' time. But I think what I am trying to set out today is, first of all, highlight the importance of that continued investment so that we continue to see that trajectory and the increase in that trajectory continue over the course of the coming years.
Okay. I hear your comment. I think my concern is that a lot of money has been spent or allocated and we're not near the target. But we'll move on to the next question, which comes from the Deputy Convener, Ben McPherson. Ben.
Thank you, Convener. Good morning, both Cabinet Secretaries and to all your officials. And thank you for all the engagement and work that's been put into this budget, particularly in the challenging circumstances of a 10% capital reduction. One of those areas of capital spending that I'm very pleased to see progressing as the constituency MSP for Edinburgh North and Leith is the investment in the Royal Botanical Gardens of Edinburgh. 350-year plus history, over 13,500 plant species, many of which are endangered or extinct in their native habitats. So the importance of this institution, as well as being a major visitor attraction, should not be underestimated. So as part of that and protecting what the Botanics has for the future, the investment in the Edinburgh Biodomes project is the Royal Botanical Gardens' biggest ever capital infrastructure project and, as many will know, aims to produce a world-leading facility for biodiversity research and for the public to be able to engage with more of what the Botanics does. So I just wondered, Ms Goujon, if you could update the committee on the future of the Biodomes project and any commitments the Scottish Government has made to help secure its future, and will the £17 million allocation in capital funding in this budget enable the project to progress with its full original plans, noting what Audit Scotland said last year?
Thank you very much. And I think it would just echo all the points you've made there about the importance of the Royal Botanic Gardens in Edinburgh. And obviously, they have 4 sites across Scotland that they cover, but they do undertake such vital work in terms of the collections that they hold, their research capability, let alone the sites that they run for visitors and the events that they run within that as well. So in the budget as published, committee members will no doubt be aware that there has been a slight reduction in terms of that of £1.8 million. So that's a 5% reduction, and that's been to the capital element of the budget. I would just want to highlight that the only reason that there is a reduction in the capital element of the budget, that relates exactly to the phasing of the biomes project, as that's been set out. So not a cut to the project, but just in terms of the phasing and how that's working out at the moment. So that's why the spend is set out as it is. But overall, there's a £58 million contribution to the Edinburgh Biomes project. So £58 million of that has come from the Low Carbon Fund, as well as a further £8 million from Scottish Government too. It is a hugely important project. And I think that's why the ongoing commitment to the funding of that is so important and is going to be so vital for the Botanic Gardens going forward too.
Thank you very much for that, Cabinet Secretary. Just for clarity, it's understandable that because of the staging and the phasing of such a big project, that there are fluctuations in the figures year to year. But are you emphasising today that there's a commitment to progressing with the full plans that the Botanics agreed with the government in the infancy of the project? I should say that in the context of when I recently met with the Botanics, they emphasised to me how good the engagement with the Scottish Government was at official level and ministerial as well.
Yes, absolutely. And I would just want to emphasise that point as well. And I met with their board just before Christmas to get an update on some of the key pieces of work that they're doing at the moment. But again, I would just re-emphasise that commitment from the Scottish Government that we are still committed to the biomes project. And again, we're only seeing the reduction in the funding because of the phasing of the project, but the overall commitment still stands.
Thank you.
Okay. Thank you, Cabinet Secretary. Just before we move on to the next section, I want to make a declaration so members know that I have an interest in a family farming partnership. I also have an interest in wild fishery. And I have interest in trees, although I haven't received any planting grant, I think, in the last 10 years. And I have no intention, as I said last week, of applying for a planting grant in the foreseeable future. So, just so that's on record and people understand that I do have an interest in land. And the next questions therefore come to Monica. Monica.
Thank you, Convener, and nothing to declare here. And good morning to our Cabinet Secretaries and all our witnesses today. As you know, we've been doing quite a lot of work on biodiversity and scrutinising government proposals in that area. So I'd like to hear from each Cabinet Secretary if you could both identify the key funding streams for the terrestrial and marine environments in both of your portfolios, which are designed to deliver on the biodiversity strategy. Come to Ms Goodjohn first, please. The Cabinet Secretary for Rural Affairs.
Sorry, I wasn't able to unmute myself there. But in relation to biodiversity, obviously that cuts across both myself and the Cabinet Secretary for Net Zero's portfolios quite strongly. We've just outlined in some of the previous responses there in relation to the natural resources element of the budget and specific areas that funds. Two, we also have, probably a number of different budget lines within my portfolio where we're taking action on biodiversity, not least in relation to agriculture.
We're getting interference in the line. I wonder if we could just pause it. I'm struggling to hear the answer.
Just wondering if we could, just before you go on with the answering the question, could you, Cabinet Secretary, could you just say a few words just so I can see if the interference is still there?
Okay, sorry, can you hear me okay now?
I'm afraid it's still there. So I'm just wondering, I think what I'm going to do is I'm going to suspend the meeting briefly and see if we can re-establish the connection and see if we can get the sound a bit better. I'm sorry, Cabinet Secretary, but we're not hearing all that you want to say. So we'll suspend briefly and we'll come back shortly. Okay, I think we're back in action. Marie Goujon, can you hear me? And can you say a few words just to make sure that I'm happy that I can hear you?
Yes, I can, and hopefully you can hear me okay, convener.
That is a lot better with no interference. So we'll go back to the question that Monica posed. And just because there's been a bit of a break, Monica, could you start that one again, please, for us?
Thank you, and welcome back, Ms Goujon. Yeah, I was asking about biodiversity, given the committee's interest in that strand of work. So it was to ask each of you to identify the key funding streams for the terrestrial and marine environments in both of your portfolios, which are designed to deliver on the biodiversity strategy.
Right, thank you. And just as I was touching on previously, and I don't know if you caught any of the first bit of the response that I'd given there, but obviously this is an area that cuts quite strongly across both my portfolio and that of the Cabinet Secretary for Net Zero as well. But I think if you're looking for specific funding, where those budget lines might be, I think that one of the key lines we've touched on already in terms of the natural resources and that line within the budget there, but also when I look to the agriculture element of my portfolio. So we have around £30 million that's been made available there in terms of our agri-environment work. So a large part of that, of course, is the agri-environment climate scheme, which is about that climate mitigation, adaptation, lowering emissions, as well as enhancing biodiversity within that. That's just one example. And there's also specific funds within the Marine Directorate as well, which contribute to enhancing biodiversity. Of course, trying to tackle the climate and nature crises that we face is a key element of our blue economy vision. And we also have the £14 million, which has been put in place for Marine Fund Scotland, where it's really about supporting those projects right across our fisheries, seafood, aquaculture too, that are going to deliver on our blue economy vision. So there are specific projects that can be funded within that are focused on biodiversity. We also have funding when I think of particular species. I know that in relation to wild salmon, for example, we had a wild salmon strategy, and we'd also introduced the implementation plan in relation to that as well. And work through that, we've supported with about £1.5 million of funding. But I think that's where, and no doubt the Cabinet Secretary for Net Zero will touch more on this, is the Nature Restoration Fund has been really critical to all that as well. So while I have these particular budget lines within my own portfolio, when I look at some of the wild salmon work, some of that has been funded, the funding for that has been enhanced through the Nature Restoration Fund, where that's looked at, I think, planting further upstream. And we've also seen schemes in relation to farming and agriculture that have been funded through the Nature Restoration Fund as well. But as I say, the Cabinet Secretary for Net Zero may want to set out more on that.
Thank you. So I'll come to Ms McCallan to
thank
add
you.
To that.
Thank you very much for the question. And just to add to what Ms Goujon has already set out, I would probably point for the most concise overview to the environmental services line within my portfolio budget that overall is seeing a 4% increase across the lines on average. Within that, I would draw out the last point that Ms Goujon was making there, the Nature Restoration Fund. That, of course, is our multi-annual £65 million fund, for which around £29 million is being made available, proposed to be made available in the coming year for Nature Restoration Fund purposes, for biodiversity strategy purposes, and that's a 5% increase on that particular line from 23-24. I would also point to the funding for our national parks, the Cairngorms and Loch Lomond, again on this budget line, and again a slight increase on last year, 1% increase across the piece. And I think it's also important to draw attention to the public bodies within my responsibility, Nature Scot and SEPA, although principally Nature Scot, in respect of Ms Lennon's question. Nature Scot is seeing an increase of 6.7% on its funding from last year, 7.3% for SEPA, but as I say, I think Nature Scot is the most important to that particular question.
Thank you. I may come back to the issue of SEPA later on. If I can, I just want to ask about one aspect of the budget. So we know there's been large reductions in woodland grants and agri-environment funding in the rural affairs portfolio. I'll just say that for shorthand. So back to Ms Goujon, how confident are you that these sectors will be able to deliver the really important work on biodiversity and climate needs with smaller funding pots?
There's no doubt that the significant reduction we've seen in the forestry grant scheme in particular is going to have an impact, not least on us meeting our targets. As I set out at the Rural Committee last week, as well as in my opening statement to the committee. What I would say in relation to the Agri-Environment Climate Scheme that you've mentioned there in particular, so the funding that we have available for that, so that runs on, H runs on 5-yearly contracts. So I think about between 16 and 17 million of that are previous contracts that have been agreed. But the funding that we have available for the Agri-Environment Scheme, which is probably one of the key schemes that we have for delivering on our climate and nature ambitions in relation to agriculture in particular, will enable us to fund, I think, the vast majority of applications that we've seen to AICs over the course of 2023. But there is no getting around it. I mean, I'm not particularly happy sitting in front of the committee today with the cuts in the capital that we've seen. I know Ms McAllen said at the start of the meeting, just the context that we're facing in relation to the overall budget, and no doubt you'll have heard that from the Deputy First Minister last week as well. But I think particularly for my own portfolio, where about 2/3 of that is ring-fenced, when we were members of the EU and we had that certainty of funding over a 7-year period, we would also get that funding through as a mix of resource and capital, whereas the replacement funding that we get from the UK government only comes through as resource. So it's the capital element of the budget where we really do see those significant constraints and why we are trying to manage that as best we can across the portfolio and really try and focus and prioritise on these key schemes that we do know make a difference, as well as ensuring that we're maintaining and building on the momentum that we've seen in relation to, you know, whether that's forestry, whether that's peatland as well. So we are trying to do the best that we can within the budgets that we have available.
Thank you. Now, you were quite honest there about, you know, issues that you're not happy with. We've heard from a number of unhappy stakeholders since the session we had last week with the Deputy First Minister, because one of the examples we looked at was the woodland grant funding, known as the forestry grant scheme, and that faces a cut of 41%, which is huge. That's roughly £32 million in the next financial year. We're aware of the annual underspend that has been occurring in that area, but this would still double that area of underspend. So we've heard from Woodland Trust Scotland, who are very concerned, and Stop Climate Chaos Scotland. So I wonder, Cabinet Secretary, because we've been asking a lot about confidence in meeting emissions reduction targets, but do you agree with Woodland Trust Scotland that the proposed cut will only serve to make the gap between the targets and delivery even wider?
First of all, just to say that I completely understand the concerns that have been expressed by stakeholders. I think that we had been disappointed with the overall planting rate that we saw last year, which did fall short of, fell far short of our expected targets. And that's why I'd held a woodland creation summit just earlier in December last year to try and get to grips with what the key issues were that led to that, how we can try and address that and really try and scale that up going forward and get closer to meeting some of the targets that we've had. I mean, notwithstanding that and the budget pressures that we're currently facing in relation to woodland grants in particular, as you've highlighted, that the overall budget for that is down by 40%. I think that event was really vital in helping us identify what those challenges are, and I think it still gives us a lot to build on and highlights a lot of work that we can do. But undoubtedly, it means that we would be unable to meet our planting targets for the current year. But I think what is really important for us from now on is ensuring that we can still plant and get as many trees in the ground as possible. At that summit, we'd actually had a record number of approvals in the pipeline. It was over 13,000 at that point, and I think we're now looking at closer to 14,000 hectares worth of approvals there. So we want to make sure that we are fully utilising the budget that's available over the course of this current financial year, but also looking to the budget that is available to next year to see. And I know that there's been discussions with partners in the sector as well as to how we can look to best utilise that and really try and keep that momentum going as best we possibly can. But I mean, I think overall within that context, I think we shouldn't lose sight of the fact that we are still doing a huge amount of planting. When you look at the levels being planted across the UK, in Scotland we're planting 62% of the what's being planted across the UK as in total. So while there's no getting away from the impact of the budget and what that's going to do this year, I think it's not it's important not to forget the real progress that we've made when it's coming to really try and develop the industries, develop the sector, and really try and increase the rates of planting.
Thank you. I mean, I think we'd all welcome the fact there's been that summit and that engagement and a recognition that there are challenges. But while some progress may have been made, the amount of new woodland created has fallen over each of the last 5 years. We can't just look at one single year. That's been the direction of travel. So I can understand why stakeholders who have expertise and operate on the front line are writing to this committee, because they know you're coming here today, Cabinet Secretary, and they're saying that they're really worried. And they're asking that if the resource allocation is not increased, what action will the government take to focus on woodland types that provide the greatest emissions benefit? So I think people are quite realistic that this 41% cut isn't going to be massively reduced. But what other actions and mitigations are you going to take?
Well, that's the exact work that's happening just now, because I think that I'd announced some changes to the forestry grant scheme last year, because obviously we want to see more riparian planting, we want to see more agroforestry. I think the grants and the rates of grant that we've made available for those smaller schemes as well are really hugely important to try and encourage that, and that we continue that encouragement going forward as well. So again, it's about the engagement that we have with the sector now to see how we can best utilise that available budget that we have. And again, I would just come back to, that is why the summit that we had in December was so important, because some of the actions that were identified around that were about improvements that we can make to the woodland development process, how we can really try and help and better develop people across the sector as well. So all of that work can continue. And of course, I think we would all be wanting to see the full utilisation of the budget that's there to ensure that we are getting as many trees in the ground as possible. And that work will very much continue from here. I just want to make sure that we are utilising the available budget that we have as best as we possibly can. And of course, we will be engaging with our key stakeholders as we look to do that.
Okay. Thank you, Ms. Gugent. Well, I want to now turn to Ms. McCallan, because I think the committee, we are keen to better understand how Cabinet Secretaries are working together to ensure that biodiversity and climate goals in the transport net zero and just transition portfolio are supported by funded actions in the Rural Affairs, Land Reform and Islands portfolio, and just generally across government that we do get that proper alignment. So, you know, if we just focus on that example about the 41% reduction, you know, on woodland grant schemes, Ms. Gujon clearly isn't happy about that situation. You know, Cabinet Secretary, you can't be feeling great about it either. So how are you making sure that you are working together and fighting your corner in Cabinet? Because clearly this budget is going to make it harder for you to deliver on the targets and policies that you have in front of you.
Thanks, Ms Lennon. No, I think that's a really accurate observation about, you know, both Ms Goujon and I have talked about, and the DFM talked about, this being, you know, singularly the most challenging financial landscape in the devolution era. And for my task in climate change, we all know that that is a task that requires you to do everything everywhere right across the piece. So when there are financial challenges across the piece, of course, it's going to be a concern for me, because so many interventions are needed to deliver on climate change. I'm not going to take the opportunity to theorise on Ms Goujon's budget, but you're absolutely right that there are implications for me, and in particular in this year as we develop the climate change plan. So I will have to consider the development of the climate change plan. In light of 1 year's budget, but also remembering that it is a plan out to 2040. It's a generational plan, and I have to be realistic about what's affordable and what's doable in the next year, coming years. But equally, I don't want us to be utterly restrained in a plan that goes right out to 2040 by the financial circumstances that we're facing just now. There's one theme right across the piece that I think needs to be explored and is being explored in order to try and not allow us to be affected detrimentally by this, and that is the leveraging in of responsible private finance. We see that in Nature with some of the work that Ms Goujon and Ms Slater are overseeing. It's a theme in what I'm trying to do in the decarbonisation of transport. We now need to realise that we must make progress on climate change, but equally scarce public funds will have to be utilised where they are most required, and we will have to seek to leverage in responsible private finance, both individual and institutional. And we can come back to
points
some of that.
Yeah. We'll have to move on to other members' questions, and I'll come back later with some of mine. But on that point about private finance, I think everyone recognises that public finance alone isn't going to get us to net zero. But on private finance, are you concerned with some of the reports we've seen even in recent days about some of the investment decisions taken by the Scottish National Investment Bank, particularly around the Gresham House Fund, around forestry, and how that might be actually undermining our objectives around land reform, around community wealth building and just transition, when we see that some of these investments actually might be more beneficial to funds sitting in New York than to communities here in Scotland? Is that something that you're actively looking at?
Well, certainly my view, and when I used to sit as Ms Goujon's junior minister with the land reform responsibilities and oversight of investment in natural capital, which I don't have now, incidentally. It was absolutely my view that we should, as a government, set our expectations of what responsible private investment in nature looked like. That's why I oversaw the launch of the Principles for Responsible Investment as part of the NSET. I absolutely trust the National Investment Bank to do their job and to make their decisions on a commercial basis. I'm not going to comment on the work that they do, but for the government's purposes, we absolutely do have expectations, and they have been put in train in a piece of work that I started when I was the Minister for Environment.
I think it was Douglas Lumsden, MSP, who raised concerns last week that the advisory board that should be in place under the legislation isn't yet in place. Just finally then, on Gresham House Fund and Scottish National Investment Bank, Ms Goujon, the Ferret had a big report in the last couple of days. Are you concerned by what you've heard? I'm not sure if Ms Goujon can hear me, or
she can. Sorry, I can't hear you, but I just wasn't able to come off mute there. No, because I do think you raise a really important point, and I suppose I would largely echo what Ms McAllen has set out there too. But that's where I think I would just want to touch on a couple of pilot projects that are underway at the moment and really are key to ensuring that we get this right. I mean, I think we've talked about many times before that the level of public investment that we need to address the challenges that we're facing is never going to be enough. So I think private investment is going to be a critical part of that, but it's ensuring that that is done in a responsible way and that communities do see the benefit of that is really important. So, of course, we have there are a couple of pilots underway with Nature Scot at the moment. So one of those is, I think, a £2 billion private investment project, which is really that's centrally focused on the principles for responsible private investment that Ms McCallan talked about as well, and that she was responsible for bringing forward and implementing in her previous ministerial role, and ensuring that we get that right from the start, that there is that engagement with communities are very much part of that process and see the benefit of it. I'd be happy to follow up with the committee and provide more information on that pilot in terms of how it's going, but I believe it is operating quite well at the moment. But we also have the pilot fund. I think there's £3 million available as part of that at the moment, and it's investment in Nature Ready Scotland as well, which, again, there are, I think, nearly 30 projects that are underway as part of that as well, with these principles very much at the forefront, and to make sure that we do get that private investment right. And you're absolutely right in relation to where we want to be with land reform, ultimately what we're setting out in the goals that we want to see with that. So that's where I'm keen that any sort of investment that we see aligns with our ultimate goals and visions and what we're trying to achieve in that respect.
Thank you. Back to you, Convener.
OK, just before we leave the forestry planting issue, I mean, the government's long signalled their intention to plant more and more trees, I think, since 2016 when I was elected. And only in 2 years since then have we met the planting targets. In fact, I think we're 17,600 hectares behind where we should be. So there's an industry out there that's gone out and grown all the trees based on what your planting targets are. And it now appears from reports that they're going to pulp them and destroy them because they can't plant them because there's a shortfall in the planting grant. What's your message to them, Ms Goujon?
Again, that is where the engagement that is happening right now and how we move forward with the available budget and having those conversations is going to be absolutely critical, because we want to ensure, I mean, as I said in one of my previous responses, we have 14,000 hectares worth of approvals coming forward. We want to make sure that we get all of that planted and that we're utilising the available budget as best we can. Now, that means that there could potentially be some tweaks within that in terms of how we've previously awarded funding to how that might go forward, to make sure that we're really maximising the impact of that as much as we possibly can. Ultimately, we do not want to be in the position where we've really helped to drive forward the industry, and the whether that's nurseries, wider industry, timber, as well as the encouragement that we've tried to do with farmers and crofters to see more agroforestry and the riparian planting that I talked about as well. We don't want to see that scale back. We want to really try and continue with the momentum that has been building. You're absolutely right in that we haven't met each of our planting targets over previous years. Again, that's why I'd said we'd had the Woodland Summit towards the end of last year to really try and address what was a significant shortfall from the target of the previous year. But we'd be very much, again, I've been encouraged by the level of approvals that we've seen come through for this year. So that's why I want to make sure we're utilising all the available funding that we have. And we will very much continue to work with the sector to ensure that we're all working together to try and really deliver on the goals that I think we all want to see. And we want to see a thriving forestry sector. It's worth so much to our economy as well as to our timber supply, not least when you look at the climate impact of all of that as well. So we want to make sure that we're working together with them going forward.
I think, Cabinet Secretary, I hear what you're saying. My concern is the forestry industry isn't something like a tap. You can't turn it on and off when you want it. And a huge amount of preparation goes into reaching your goals. So they need to be long-term goals. Otherwise, we're never going to achieve them. And maybe we can agree on that, because I see you nodding. And I'm sure you'll be working on the work that was undertaken by Mr. McKinnon on the forestry report to ensure that it's easier to plant trees rather than more difficult to plant trees, which might give the industry some confidence. Now, the next question comes from the Deputy Convener, Ben McPherson. Ben.
Thank you, Convener. And a question for you, Cabinet Secretary, in the room, if that's OK, please. Scotland is rightly well known for its remarkable nature, and that's part of its attraction and also what makes it a great place to live. But also increasingly being known for having a remarkable renewables industry, a growth in net zero technology development and installation of technologies to produce renewable electricity from onshore wind to offshore wind to other technologies like tidal, and that requires development of our ports and a whole range of other infrastructure projects. Last week, when I was engaging with the Cabinet Secretary for Wellbeing, Economy, Fair Work and Energy, both at committee and in the Chamber as well, we discussed the need for NatureScot and the Marine Directorate to have sufficient capacity in its planning and licensing teams to support the government's net zero infrastructure ambitions, and indeed Scotland's more widely ambitions in this place, both in terms of scale and pace, to ensure that renewables are scaled up in harmony with nature, and that we, where it's appropriate, deliver the projects that so many of us, whether that's developers, the energy industry and the government and the populace want to see. So I just wondered if you could comment on budgetary terms how you look at those infrastructure ambitions across government and between your directorates to ensure that we're avoiding consenting or licensing bottlenecks, which can be costly, but also ensuring that there is robust consenting, but these decisions are made and supported by good evidence and done as quickly as possible so we can realise these projects and Scotland's potential.
Thank you very much, Mr McPherson. I wholeheartedly...
Sorry, just to clarify, Murray McCallum's going on that. Murray Goujon, she beat you to the button. So she'll go first and then you'll get a chance to come in.
Sorry, Murray. It's a bit confusing with the same names and everything. No, I think the question's really welcome, because I think the fact that ScotWind and renewables has been discussed in respect of your discussions with the Deputy First Minister, with the Cabinet Secretary for Energy, and now with me, and I presume with others, it demonstrates how multifaceted it is, but also what a strategic priority it is for government and for the committee and for the communities that all of us represent. It is one of the single greatest socio-economic opportunities that we face in Scotland, and of course is central to our work on combating climate change. For my part in this portfolio, again, I think it's important to state that, you know, I have responsibility for coordination of the net zero achievements across the government, but portfolio responsibility for transport, heat, decarbonisation, etc. Energy sits with Mr Gray, as you know, rural affairs with Ms Goujon, but it's my job to coordinate that response. So for energy purposes within my portfolio, you're absolutely right to mention that one of the main interfaces is about consenting and about the interplay between protecting the environment and ensuring that we can move through the consenting and construction and operationalisation of our energy projects. Two examples that I could draw your attention to. First of all, with NatureScot, I mentioned that they had a 6.7% increase in their budget this year. This is to reflect an increase in responsibilities, one of the principle of which is their role with habitats assessments in respect to the development of offshore wind. So my expectation, and I will set this out to them, is that part of that will go to recruitment to make sure that there is capacity there to deal with those applications as promptly as we need them to. Another example within an area shared with Ms Goujon and I would point to Marine Scotland, following the completion of ScotWind Round 1, the leasing round. The government moved to create a ScotWind Directorate within the government, headed up by Michelle Quinn, who has got a huge amount of experience in infrastructure development in Scotland. And that, again, is to make sure that there is that real laser focus on moving through the very complex procedures that are required to realise this potential. But that's just two examples from my portfolio.
Thank you. Cabinet Secretary Goujon, did you want to add to that?
Yes, I did. And sorry for launching myself into that question there, but I think I was really just wanting to touch on, I think, the final point that has been raised by Ms McCallum there in relation to looking at from a marine directorate perspective. So there had been an increase in budget for Marine Scotland last year, I think specifically in relation to that. There, in relation to the overall marine directorate budget, though, there has been a slight decrease
in relation to that, but that's been because of a number of different, whether that's recruitment controls, operational efficiencies that have been looked at in terms of generating some of those savings. But they've also, there has been a real focus on maximising the income streams to the Marine Directorate as well. So obviously they have revenues that come in from commercial science activity. There's the licensing fees, energy consenting fees. But it's also important to highlight, I think, just the sheer scale of the work that the Marine Directorate undertakes. You talk about the offshore and consenting and the energy consents, which is a huge element of that work as well. But we also have another vitally important component is our marine science and research. And in relation to our fisheries and seafood as well, there's also the enforcement and compliance costs within the Marine Directorate too. So I really just wanted to add some more of the context there and set out the overall budget position within that.
Thank you both. That is reassuring that there's both that attention and investment and also the coordination across government, and including the creation of a Scotland Directorate, most welcome. I guess I just emphasise the point because some of the feedback from those developing renewable technologies has been on certain projects to date. There has, in their view, been a delay, which has added to inflationary cost, etc. So it is a risk for our development of our renewable potential, the consenting process being unnecessarily slow, but also I appreciate the time it takes to create expertise, to develop capacity in terms of recruitment. So I'm glad to hear there's the work that's ongoing and that it's very much something that you're both focused on.
Convener, to that I wholeheartedly agree. I had the pleasure of attending the Scottish Renewables Offshore Wind dinner last week to accompany their conference, which the First Minister spoke at. And what Mr McPherson has narrated there was reflected in the conversations I was having with developers, with supply chain representatives. Definitely a feeling of we must speed this up, we must refine the processes, but equally an acknowledgement that that's because we're pioneering here. You know, ScotWind being the largest floating offshore wind leasing round in the world, we're doing some of it for among the first times, but that doesn't take away from the fact that we must refine it and we must speed it up.
Thank you. Thank you, Camilla.
Mark, I think you wanted a brief supplementary and then I'm going to go to Douglas.
Yeah, thanks, Convener. I mean, and good to hear about the increasing budget for Nature Scot and the strategic focus of that on particularly bringing down consenting times and contributing to that renewables growth. But I just wanted to ask Marie Goujon about the pressures then that exist within the Marine Directorate. And, you know, you've already talked about the increasing revenue that's coming in through licensing, which is good. But are there particular pressures there in terms of the breadth of work that the Marine Directorate is undertaking right now? I'm particularly thinking about fisheries, you know, the need to make good on the commitment to introduce a cap on the inshore that again is science-based, so that will require obviously an investment in terms of the science, the fisheries science. But are there particular, you know, stretches, I guess, within the next year that the Marine Directorate is facing?
Of course there are, because I think probably as I highlighted in my previous response, it is a very busy directorate and there's always a lot of work that's being undertaken. So of course we have to prioritise within that in terms of the work that's undertaken and where that real focus needs to be. But I mean, what really guides us within that is the, you know, I talked earlier about the blue economy vision and really embedding the outcomes that we want to see from that and really being a focus for our work. When I was at the Rural Committee last week as well, I also spoke about the science and innovation strategy, which is guiding how we prioritise our work in that area too, and where the key areas of focus are going to be. Obviously, because we do have limited resource, we can't undertake all the science and research that ideally we would like to. We have two research vessels. I think our overall spend on science is over £20 million, about £10.5 million of that is in relation to fisheries. And then we also have the cost of the two research vessels within that, which equates to about £6.5 million of funding as well. So that's why the science and innovation strategy is really important, because what it talks about within that is how we can best utilise the academic and science research expertise that we have within Scotland, really map the work that's ongoing at the moment, look at how we can better coordinate and collaborate with different partners in Scotland, as well as looking internationally as well, and see where we can really maximise on the benefit of the work that we're doing. So I think that was, and the Science and Innovation Strategy was just launched in Aberdeen a couple of weeks ago. So I think that's really key in focusing science and how we move that forward. But of course, Scotland has such a vast sea area. Our enforcement and compliance in terms of our marine protected area network is also of critical importance. So when you look at what we have to fund within that, we have 18 area offices, 2 surveillance aircraft, we have 3 marine protection vessels, all of which, of course, must be funded. And I think the total cost around that are about £30 million as well. And sorry, we have two RIBs as part of that too. So it is a huge area to cover. And that's why there's also, when I talked about the operational efficiencies that the Marine Directorate has been looking at, it's really trying to best focus and utilise the resources that we do have. And in relation to enforcement and compliance, that's meant that greater focus on using intelligence and doing risk-based analysis before deploying vessels and aircraft too. So I think the whole way of working has been considered across the piece in the Marine Directorate, which is how those savings have been identified, as well as then looking to maximise the income streams that they have available.
Thank you. I'm going to encourage everyone for short questions and perhaps very short answers where possible. Otherwise, I'm going to get into trouble with my committee members, cabinet secretaries. So the next question is from Douglas Lumsden.
Thanks, Convener, and I've got a short question. So, I'll address this to Marty McCallan. How confident are you that the spending decisions taken in the 24-25 budget set a course for meeting the interim 2030 and final 2045 emissions reduction targets in Scotland?
Thank you, Mr. Lumsden, for the question. It's one that's certainly dominated my thoughts a lot as we've been developing the budget. I think, first of all, again, I would just come back to that point of context that I made earlier. We are still dealing with annualised budgets, self-contained within 1 year. And as you rightly point out, the interim target is 2030 and the mid-century target 2045. So on one hand, I'm planning policy over a generation. And on the other hand, I'm having to think very carefully, as you're right to point out, about the implications of 1 year's budget on that. Despite the exceptionally difficult circumstances that we have faced, I am comfortable that this budget has gone as far as possible to supporting climate change objectives. I think I set out at the start that my 3 principal objectives were, firstly, to meet my legal and contractual obligations, secondly, to have a safe and reliable transport network, and 3, to make sure that we were responding to the climate emergency. And I think the work that we've done with the Net Zero Committee on the joint budget review has allowed clarity on the extent to which this budget supports climate objectives. And of course, we know that £4.7 billion, I think, is the figure, which has overall been identified as positive actions within the whole budget supporting climate change. And of course, there's key examples I would draw out from that: heat in buildings, active travel, flooding as a key adaptation move, public transport, concessionary travel, etc. But I'll let you come back in.
Yes, and I will come back, because obviously you said earlier that we must make progress in climate change, which is so it's surprising when we look at the budget. In terms of resource and capital, the figures we've got from SPICE shows that resource and capital together, in terms of real terms, budget is up. But when we look at the transport, net zero and just transition budget, it's actually down in real terms by 1.8%. And you know, we can look at lines like the agri-environmental measures. You know, that's had a huge cut. Woodland grants have got a huge cut. So I'm just trying to work out, you know, as you've said, climate change, we must make progress. So how do we make progress when we see cuts to the overall budget in terms of transport, net zero and just transition? And we've also, as we heard right at the start, in terms of the climate change assessment figures of the budget, they're incorrect. So how do we match those two things together?
So just Finally, on that point, which was referring to Phil Raines' point at the beginning, those issues were brought to my attention minutes before coming to see you today, and I'm really concerned that it's absolutely clarified to you later on today. I'll make sure that's done. But as Phil said, my understanding is that the figures throughout the budget are absolutely accurate, except for some in Annex J, which are draft figures and not the final ones. But I will absolutely ensure that's clarified for you. Ultimately, I think that, you know, I've got £4.6 billion for transport, net zero and just transition, part of an overall Scottish Government budget, which, through the joint budget review work, we can identify that £4.7 billion is positive for climate action. That's, I think, 75% of capital spend, a smaller percentage of revenue spend, but ultimately much of that revenue spend is health services and social security and staff, etc., as I know that the Deputy First Minister took you through. One observation I would make is that, if we assess real-term spending against the Treasury GDP deflators, we can see real terms cuts to services coming to Scotland. So by not matching real term spend over 2 years, in 24-25, UK government's transport resource investment is down 40%, their environment, food and rural affairs is down 12.4%, and energy security and net zero is down 14.1%. Of course, this has knock-on consequences for what I'm dealing with, but I believe that even in those very difficult circumstances, this draft budget allows me to maintain a safe and reliable transport system and rises to the climate emergency.
Even the Scottish Fiscal Commission, their figures are showing that in real terms, 0.9%, your budget is 0.9% bigger. But that's why it seems surprising to me that we see rises to many budgets. But in terms of the transport net zero and just transition budget, that's cut. Rural affairs, land and reforms and islands budget is cut. So it's political decisions that you've taken that may hinder our response to climate change.
So the figure that I have for my overall budget is up 1.1%, but we may be talking at cross purposes with inflation taken into account in different figures, so I will certainly check that out. But, as I said, £2.5 billion on public transport, £308 million on active travel and low-carbon transport, £358 million to decarbonise our heat and buildings, £225 million on environmental services, £91 million on flooding and coastal change, and increases for both my environmental public bodies in a very, very difficult budget settlement. I think that is a reasonable position to have come to.
So is the Woodland Grants cut going to help or hinder climate change?
So, just as before, the decisions on Woodland, it's not right for me to speak to in a budgetary sense because they are Ms Goujon's responsibility, but I accept my overall responsibility for climate change makes them relevant to me. As I've said, I will have to consider this, what's likely to be achievable in this year as I plan the climate change plan, but equally, and it goes to the point I made before about the need for responsible private investment across the piece in order to rise to our climate objectives. That will be required in nature, just as it is in transport, just as it is to decarbonise our buildings. And policy teams across government are turning their minds to how we realise that.
Okay, thanks, Convener.
Just as you mentioned, Cabinet Secretary, could you just confirm the climate change plan, which we're still awaiting, will have figures in it so we can see what's required to achieve the targets that are being set?
So, come back to me if this is not the question you asked, Convener, but the climate change plan, a draft of which is due with this committee by no later than November this year, will set sectoral envelopes, as plans have done in the past, will identify policies capable of reducing emissions commensurate with those envelopes, and will set that out in detail to allow you to scrutinise that.
So, I think November's quite tight if we're to scrutinise it within the time period that's given and for it to go back to the Parliament. I would hope that as a committee we might get it before November, having looked forward to it before Christmas. But what I'm trying to work out in my mind is the figures to achieve the target, the actual cost to achieve the targets, that will be in the climate change plan.
The costs.
Yes.
Convener, I'm going to let my colleague Phil come in. Sorry, I thought you meant the emissions reduction figures, but I'm going to let Phil
come in. About the cash to achieve the targets, yep. Cabinet Secretary. We're on money today.
So, Convener, maybe pick up two points. One is, As the Cabinet Secretary said, no later than November. So our firm intention would be to get it to show the firm respect to the committee to give you the due consideration, the ability to be able to examine that as appropriate. The legislation says the draft needs to be there by November, so that's why we're repeating that back. The legislation also says that the climate change plan pretty much has to show your homework, and that includes the cost. That includes how much it's going to cost going forward out to 2040, including the impacts all the way and what each measure needs to achieve. So that needs to be very clear and set out in the plan, because that's what the legislation requires.
So the figures are in there, and it will be no later than November, hopefully much earlier. Monica, you've got some questions before I end this session with both Cabinet Secretaries.
Yeah, thank you, Convener. Just thinking back to Douglas Lumsden's sort of line of questions, I think, Ms McCallan, you said that, you know, we need to think about private finance in terms of, you know, helping us meet these really important policy aims. I just wonder if enough thought has been given to opportunities to make polluters pay and to incentivise emissions reduction in the design of revenue-raising measures. Are there any examples that you could give us today, briefly?
Yes, sorry, I didn't quite catch the first part of your question, but absolutely understand what you're asking. Yes, there are. I would point to maybe two examples that come to mind. First of all, with SEPA, 50% of SEPA's revenue is raised from charging regimes for those that they regulate, and that is an example of making polluters pay for the public service that SEPA provide, a very successful one which has seen SEPA's overall revenue increase of late, and the proportion of that be somewhat public spend and some of it raised from those they're regulating. Another example I might point to is work that Ms Slater is taking forward within my portfolio on extended producer responsibility, much of which I know this committee is looking at in respect of the Circular Economy Bill and waste route map. That and the sums that could be raised from polluters in that work would be another example I would point to.
It's been identified in terms of what the sort of minimum, maximum range of that could be.
Sorry, in what regard?
Has any modelling been done to identify how much could be raised from those examples you've given?
I don't have them in front of me, Ms Lennon. I'm sorry. I mean, I could certainly find, just from auditing, the figure, for example, that SEPA have raised in respect to their charging. Yeah. And I know that the financial aspects of the Circular Economy Bill are something that the committee is looking very closely at.
Yes, indeed. No, thank you. And I talked about confidence levels earlier on. So, again, for Ms McCallan, how confident are you that the spending decisions taken in the 24-25 budget set a course for meeting the interim 2030 and the final 2045 emission reduction targets in Scotland?
So, we're already working on very ambitious targets, which was absolutely right. I mentioned earlier how the scale and pace of climate change means we need action right now, right across the piece, economy and society. So it's an enormous task which none of us should seek to minimise, and I'm not going to do that. I can't pretend that a near 10% cut in what's available to me in terms of capital spend is not going to have an impact on this when it comes to expensive projects like the decarbonisation of transport, our heat and buildings work. So I have done my very best with what I have had available to me, and I will seek to fill the gaps where necessary by leveraging funding from elsewhere in the private sector, both institutional and individual, and by using public money to the very best that it can be used and stretch it as far as it can go.
Well, on that, you'll be aware that at last week's session with your colleague, Cabinet Secretary for Wellbeing Economy, and also the Deputy First Minister, we looked at the ScotWind auction and the money that's been raised so far. I won't narrate all of what was discussed because I'm sure you've been briefed on that. But concerns have been raised that money, which had been you know, promised it would be used for the energy transition and for green policies. We now know that it's gone into the general budget, and we know about the £56 million from the emergency budget review. Given the challenges you have and the quite realistic view you've given us today, do you share those frustrations and concerns that income isn't being used directly for policies and projects that will have a direct benefit in terms of our climate and nature aspirations and targets? And are you able to give any update as to whether you've been given any reassurance that that money will return to the intended budget lines?
Thank you very much for the question, and I'm aware of some of the discussion that was had last week with the DFM and with Mr Gray. I think the first thing I would say is that ScotWind is supporting my budget in the sense that it's supporting the government's budget as a whole in the most difficult circumstances we've faced in devolution. The second point I would make is that the value of ScotWind is much greater than the sum of its parts. So we're talking here about option fees, there's then rental income, and then there's the real prize of unlocking the supply chain opportunities in the tens, twenties of billions of pounds. And of course, it's the whole government's objective that we realise that, not just mine, not just Mr Gray's, with energy responsibility. And as I say, some of that money is supporting net zero interventions, including, you know, for example, the money that Mr Gray has been able to make available to support the development of the supply chain. So, you know, in future, would I like to see a ring-fenced sovereign fund for these purposes that support my portfolio? Absolutely. But I am absolutely confident that the whole government is committed to realising the opportunities of ScotWind and other strategic net zero investments, and that ScotWind is already supporting that work.
So what conditions would need to be in place for something like a sovereign fund, as you've described it, to be you know, agreed to and operationalised by the government?
I think that would just be dependent on discussions at the time. I don't think it would be helpful for me to speculate about that. But as I say, my view very much just now is that ScotWind is already supporting the government's budget, a key theme of which is realising net zero.
Okay. I think many people are still struggling to see, you know, if that is indeed accurate when that money has been dispersed, if you like, across the budget piece. So in terms of the question about, do you expect any of the money to be reinstated for original purpose? Is that something that you're not able to answer? Or
just from what I've seen of the DFM's conversation with you last week, she was quite clear that she's still working through the implications of ScotWind, both for the current financial year and the future financial year. So once she has clarity on that, I'm sure she'll be happy to update the committee.
Okay, thank you.
Bob, you wanted to come in briefly. I'm going to allow a brief question and hopefully have a brief answer before we suspend at the end of this first part of the session.
It will be absolutely briefly. I need to be consistent with the line of questioning on this from last week. I made the point to the Deputy First Minister last week, Cabinet Secretary, that there's a 11.1% in the social justice and social security budget benefiting some of the most vulnerable communities across Scotland, including in my constituency in Maryhill and Springburn. The budget in the round has supported that, including the ScotWind monies, I would imagine, to get the step change we need and the buy-in of communities across Scotland. Convener, we need to stand by communities across Scotland, so I think it's vitally important that we do use those funds to support the most vulnerable communities. So I would like to put that on the record. It's not either or. We absolutely have to do both with this budget.
Secretary, do you want to agree with Mr Dorris?
I do wish to agree with Mr Dorris wholeheartedly. He's absolutely right. I mean, and I think the Deputy First Minister was the best place to give that view, which I know she did. You know, our budget as a whole increases frontline NHS investment. It uprates benefits by over £1 billion. It allows us to increase the already increased Scottish child payment, invest in blue light services and more. And ScotWind, the small portion of it that we have realised to date, is helping to support all of that, as well as key interventions in net zero.
Thank you. Now, just before we suspend the session, I just want to check Mr Simpson's here, and we'll get a chance to put questions to Mari McCallum in due course at the end of that session. Before I let Mari Goujon go, as it were, are there any questions that you wish to ask her, Mr Simpson?
No, convener. The committee's been very thorough. I would have pressed the Cabinet Secretary on woodlands, but that's been covered.
OK, thank you. So thank you, Mari Goujon, for giving evidence today. I've seen you struggling with a cough, and I can but hope that you recover swiftly and are back in Parliament when you're able. So I'm going to suspend the meeting till 10:53 exactly to allow a change of witnesses, and we'll see you back then. Thank you. Okay, and welcome back. Murray McAllen has remained at the table alongside Simon Fuller, Philip Raines and Kerry Twyman. I'm pleased to welcome Kirsty Berg, the Director for Energy Climate Change for the Scottish Government, and Alison Irvine, Interim Chief Executive of Transport Scotland. Now, Murray McAllen, you will not be surprised to know you're not getting another opening statement on this section. So we're going to move straight to questions, which are going to come from Mark Ruskell. Mark.
If I could turn to the most exciting bit, which is about the joint budget review and a number of questions around that. So, apologies, I wasn't here for the first couple of minutes of the meeting. I'm aware, though, of comments made, I think, by Philip Raines in relation to Annex J and the detail and the accuracy of detail within that. So it'll obviously be very good for the committee to get further updates on that. But can I just ask about those first two strands of work? So the overall climate kind of narrative, which I think was brought in last year, and then this year, the kind of classification or taxonomy of, you know, is spend actually helping or hindering our attempts to tackle climate change. Can I ask about where you're going with the review of those two bits of work at the moment? Is there going to be further improvements, further detail, evaluation of that? I mean, obviously, there are some accuracy issues that have been highlighted, but where do you go for next year? Because I think what's been brought forward is valuable, but it kind of always leaves you wanting more in terms of detail and a sense of, you know, what spend is exactly doing in terms of making it harder or easier to tackle the climate emergency.
Yeah, absolutely. Thank you very much. So I suppose taking strand by strand, the first one to create that dedicated climate narrative in the budget, as you say, that was largely discharged in 23-24 and continued into 24-25, and that is Annex J. And that is about highlighting those most significant areas of budgetary policy that affect net zero decisions. And for Strand 2, the objective to develop that enhanced technology taxonomy for all of Scottish Government spend. The committee will note that we have introduced it last year but expanded it this year to cover resource as well as capital, which I think was a useful continuance of the work, because that new methodology allows us to look right across revenue and capital spend, so the whole of the budget, and to consider the impact of the spend on either our mitigation or adaptation work. Now, one thing that has been highlighted to me is that it doesn't differentiate between mitigation and adaptation. So that could be an interesting area for development in the future. But I do have to say that my priority in an already busy landscape is to get that third strand completed. But I'm happy to hear from the committee, given that this is a joint piece of work, on where you think improvements might be helpful.
Yeah, yeah. I think the detail would be useful. And looking at Annex J last week, I noted that, you know, there are some adaptation elements in that. I mean, I think it was like £60,000 going into BeHealth, for example. Fantastic, great. But that's in the same pot as, you know, hundreds of millions of pounds in active travel, major investment, public infrastructure, public transport. So it's trying to get a sense of kind of scale and impact is, I think, the biggest challenge, because all we've got at the moment is kind of baskets of good things and things which are challenging. Can I ask then specifically about local government, because as I think you mentioned, that classification covers about 81% of our resource spending now, but it doesn't incorporate local government, where obviously we've got significant spend that can take us in the wrong direction or can actually propel us into tackling a climate emergency. So would that be something that you could look at going forward in terms of classification of that spend, or would that require a change in the Act or anything else?
I'll maybe come to my climate change colleagues about whether that would require a change in the Act. I think from my perspective, I absolutely appreciate the committee's interests in the closest and most detailed scrutiny that you can. I think it also helps us to improve the development of our budget, or indeed have that improve the development of policy in the first place before you even get to ascribing a budgetary figure to it. So I'm always interested in the ways that we can dig down into that. And I think, you know, local government spend is not a bad idea in that respect, because, you know, for example, I'm very conscious that my budget line shows very little in the way of flooding. But I know that my flooding line, my spend on flooding and coastal adaptation has gone up by, I can get the figure, 42% next year, but that's in the local government line. So, I mean, I would be quite keen to see how that could be combined. But, Phil, is there anything on statutory requirements that we would need to flag up just now?
Not that I'm aware of, but it does raise some important directions to travel. I mean, I'm thinking particularly about the excellent report this committee did about the role of local government within the climate change sphere last year. And you'll probably know that we are developing, we're strengthening our relationship with local government. We're trying to find a more formal way that local government and central government, in the spirit of the Verity House Agreement, can start taking forward more significant coordination and strategic thinking around climate change, very much in response to that, this committee's report last year. It strikes me that budget would be an important place to do that. Now, whether that would be where that would be reflected is something we would need to think about, because the Scottish budget is clearly not a place necessarily you would want local decisions and local spend necessarily to be reflected in that level of detail. It may not indeed be appropriate, but that's not to say we can't find a way of working with COSLA, with SOLAS, to think about the best way to be able to take forward the methodology that's being taken forward to Strand 3 with a view to being able to provide more of that transparency about how that spend, that collective public sector spend, is being made across the board. Maybe one other thing to add, I think, with regard to how this will develop in future, each of the strands are meant to speak to each other. That is, each strand comes on, as it's further developed, it enhances what goes before. And certainly our intention next year would be, once we have that baseline starting to appear, particularly with Strand 2 of the taxonomy, we're in a position where we can start demonstrating more clearly where climate change spend is starting to look like over a time series, and enhance that in the years going forward, as exactly as the Cabinet Secretary has said, by using that Strand 3 analysis to provide that more, that extra level of detail.
Okay. Yeah, I think there's definitely a lot of innovation that this committee's heard about from local government that certainly wasn't there when we were considering the 2019 Act. So, yeah, work in progress, I guess. Can I just move on then to Strand 3 and that net zero test? And, you know, we had a very useful discussion actually in Parliament last week, hosted by Monica Lennon with the Climate Emergency Response Group. I think Mr. Raines was there. We were looking at the guts of how does this net zero test actually work within government. But can I just get some clarity, Cabinet Secretary, about where the Strand 3 work sits right now? Because the Deputy First Minister, I think, said last week in this committee that the form and timing is unclear about how that will develop going forward. And I think perhaps some of your comments in the letter to the committee have been interpreted that this might not be part of an annual budget process. That wasn't my understanding of the work that was being progressed. My understanding was that this would be integral. But are you able to explain, you know, where we are with the pilots? How will this be part of the annual budget setting process? Because that surely is where meaningful decisions are made.
I'll come to you on the second part, if you don't mind. First of all, I just want to upfront apologise to the committee for the delays that have been involved in Strand 3. I'm very conscious from letters that you've received from the Deputy First Minister and I that we have given what, at the time, were our views on timetables, and there has been slippage. So I apologise for that. So the Deputy First Minister and I work on this jointly. And officials in my team have been working with officials in the Chief Economist's directorate, looking to absolutely bottom out what a methodology might be. Our expectation is that we will pilot a launch on targeted policies in the spring of 2024, with a hope to roll out by the end of 2024. So that's an update on timing and an apology of delays to date. And I'm going to ask Phil just to comment on that annual budget question.
Absolutely. And you might well argue that in a difficult budget year, rolling out a pilot is probably the best time to be doing that, because in a sense it provides that more detailed analysis to ensure that there is the full value for money being secured from the budget spend and the policy decisions that are being taken, and they absolutely meet one of the three key missions that was set up by the First Minister. So the intention would be to go forward with that pilot during the course of spring. I'm hoping it's not a civil servant spring, but one that is actually a genuine spring, I would hope by Easter, with the intention of being able to test the methodology out and then, more importantly, agree on the next steps with a view to setting in place a process of, and this is something I think that came out of the workshop that that yourself, Mr. Ruskell, and Ms. Lennon were at last week about how we use that information, because that's probably one of the critical things. How is it hardwired, embedded into the consideration of budget decisions going forward? That's still areas we need to test, but that's very much our intention, to make sure that this is not an on-the-shelf set of statistics, nor is it something that is not more deeply embedded in the way that budget decisions are considered going forward, not least, I guess, for this committee, and it'll be for this committee and others within Parliament to decide how to best make use of that information. But our intention would be to do that by the end of the calendar year, so it's very clear by this time in a year's time what we're doing, what we're setting out, and how that information is going to inform those budget decisions going forward.
So just to be clear then, the intention is that this will be across the whole of government. So when we're looking at, you know, planned investment in NHS, capital, new hospitals, refits, whatever, you know, the decisions around climate change, the decision around low carbon will be absolutely intrinsic in that thinking. Ultimately, judgments might have to be made about what to invest in, which will bring in other factors. But the climate thinking will be absolutely there. It'll be clear. It'll be evaluated, it will be numbered, it will be, judgments will be able to be made on the real value of investment in climate.
I think my end intention is that it is as broad as possible, but I suppose just in terms of prudent governance and decision making at this point, I would have to say it will be dependent on the outcome of that pilot that we do in spring.
Do you need more legislation to embed this into the work of government?
I don't know, do we?
No. I mean, as much as anything, to be honest, it's a matter for Parliament to consider whether it requires that extra level of assurance, if you will, that legislation can bring. But clearly, I think, from the programme from government and from the statements that have been made on a regular basis, I think, by cabinet secretaries coming to committees, it's the firm intention of this government to ensure that this is hardwired into the way that decisions are taken going forward.
Okay, thanks.
Very much, Mark. Bob, I think you're next. You've got a question.
Thanks, Convener. I've got an interest in how we're using public funds in this budget to roll out EV charge points, public ones across Scotland. I know there's a £30 million commitment over 4 years. We're just over halfway through it in partnership with local authorities. I think the money goes through Transport Scotland. Can I ask how much money's been drawn down so far in relation to that? And in particular to that, I see there was a budget of £4.48 million going to local authorities. I'm just quite keen to know how that's been spent and get a bit more information for it. Maybe go to a couple of follow-up questions.
Yes, of course. Sorry, I was just flicking through my enormous pack here into the transport section. So, yes, absolutely happy to give that update. So, I suppose just for the record, and this relates to the points I was making earlier about public investment to date and us being at a bit of a turning point whereafter we have to try and use public scarce public funding to leverage private support. But it's worth putting on the record that £65 million of public funding has so far delivered around 2,700 public charging points, and that has been supplemented by 1,900 additional public charging points delivered by the private sector. Now, Mr. Doris is absolutely right. As part of our EV vision and through our EV infrastructure fund, we are seeking to spend £30 million of public money and leverage £30 million from the private sector in order to reach our ambition of 6,000 public charging points by 2026. And to date, £20 million of that public funding has been made available, and that includes £4 million proposed for the coming financial year.
Now, that's helpful, and apologies, this is my initial question. I should have name-checked the fund to allow you to just have those details from your briefing pack there, CabSec. But I suppose £20 million is a significant amount of money. My understanding is that a lot of the works are in the pipeline, so technically we still don't have any additional EV public charging points yet. We don't have anything out to tender from local authorities in relation to this yet, and we're still unsure as to how much private money will be leveraged in as yet. So I think it's a reasonable question to ask, Convener, when do you think Cabinet Secretary will start to get some details of that so this committee can decide whether or not the monies that has been invested is on track to deliver the outcomes that we'll want to see? I get there's a pipeline of 2 years, but there's not been any delivery yet. I know it's a four-year plan. When can we expect to see delivery, and when can this committee get some details around that?
So I think it's an absolutely legitimate question, and I understand entirely the committee's interest in it. Mr Doris's characterisation is absolutely right, that the spend and the effort to date has been in supporting funding local authorities, supported by the Scottish Futures Trust, to come, first of all, to assess their needs in their local area, and then to, I suppose, configure scalable, investable propositions. And that is the stage that most local authorities are now at. And that's been done through their strategy and expansion plans. They will then go out to the market to procure delivery, and private investment should flow from that. So, as you say, four-year fund, front-loaded with that planning work, the next part of which will be going out to the market. And, you know, obviously I can't foresee the future, but estimates currently provided by local authorities and by market engagement with charge point operators indicates that the target will be met, the 2026 target will be met through a combination of charge points funded through this fund and by the private sector investment.
That's helpful, Cabinet Secretary. I'm not sure how much of that is in the public domain. So anything you're able to provide the committee in writing just in relation to projections would be very helpful, and when we'd actually be able to get some kind of firm details around that. I get a lot of this may be commercially confidential and things have been worked up, but I think the committee would still like to scrutinise this on an ongoing basis. So a final question, convener. I suppose this goes in partnership with the LRA spoke about a step change from individuals and families and communities, such as getting EV charge points at their own home. I know this fund's not specifically for that, or for investing in an EV vehicle. I'm conscious that there are no grants available for EV chargers at home in an urban setting, and I think the used car loan initiative has come to an end. So is that something that, in a tight financial settlement, I understand, that government may return to at a future date?
Thank you, Ms Doris. Just on the first point of your question, I will absolutely provide you in writing with anything that I can, but my comments about expectations are just that at this point. And really, until we have done that really important part of the work of local authorities going out to the market, I really can't know for sure and have the clarity that I would want to bring to the committee. On the second part, EV support for private individuals to buy it. I can't find the note exactly in my book just now, but I understand that those funds are only closed for this year and that Transport Scotland are considering the extent to which they will be available in future years. But if I've gotten that wrong, please do correct me.
I see your officials nodding their heads. So that's welcome to those. And I may declare an interest if I can persuade my other half. We may be beneficiaries of this. But the EV loan scheme for used vehicles may reopen in the next financial year.
That's correct, as of today, yeah.
OK, thank you.
I'm now totally confused. The £30 million fund that was set up to generate EV chargers, can you just clarify how many EV chargers is it actually delivered?
It is, as we discussed before, convener, that particular fund, the first portion of the spend is about planning for going out to the market, and the second half of it will be about procuring and developing. So far, the work that it has supported has not been about buying the infrastructure. It's about local authorities making very exact plans about what's required in their areas, creating those scalable propositions and going out to market.
OK, and the £30 million was to generate another £30 million of private investment.
Indeed.
How much of that £30 million of private investment has been secured from that expenditure to date?
Likewise, at the point that we are discussing this today, local authorities are not yet at the stage of going out to the market. They're still doing the preparatory work, which £20 million has gone towards. So the private investment has not yet been leveraged. The infrastructure has not yet been built, but that's why it's a programme over many years.
And just to clarify, sorry, Kerry's signalling she may want to come in. Are you just saying that, so £20 million has been spent and we've discussed a lot but not delivered anything just yet?
Well, of course, I should point out for the record that this sits alongside the £65 million that we have invested very straightforwardly in delivering 2,700 public charge points. But absolutely, as far as the EV Infrastructure Fund goes, the investment to date has very deliberately been on supporting local authorities to come up with their plans to take to the market. But I'll see if Kerry wants to come in.
Thank you. No, I was going to make the point that, 2,700 charge points have been installed under the funding which we've given Charge Points Scotland to date, which is not part of the £60 million EVA fund that, we're discussing. In terms of the £20 million, we have confirmed £20 million of funding. That hasn't actually been drawn down yet. That's the confirmation with the local authorities in discussions on the back of the pipeline that we've discussed. And that is the funding which we will start to see going out the door this financial year, when we will again hopefully start to see the match private finance initiatives coming in and those charge points being installed.
Okay, so I couldn't quite hear. Did you say 207 charge points?
No, 2,700.
2,700 charge points are being built through a different fund, but not through this fund.
Exactly.
Okay.
Already built, already in place, and those are in private homes.
Thank you. That clarifies that for me. That's helpful. The next question, I think, is from Mark Ruskell. Mark.
Thanks. Can I just ask about an aspect in relation to the Fair Fares review? Obviously, we're still waiting for the Fares review to be, released, and for there to be discussions within Parliament about the various options. I'm sure it'll set out. But in terms of what the government is currently committed to, which is the two big concessionary travel schemes, and also the announcement that was made in relation to extending that to people who are currently within the asylum system, can you just confirm that the budget for the next year kind of covers what we have in terms of concessionary travel and what the government has committed to already?
Yes, absolutely. Again, I will do that, and my colleagues from Transport Scotland come in at any stage. So concessionary fares are funded to the tune of £370 million in the draft budget, which is an increase of 3.1%. And there is funding set aside in order to progress the development of the extension of concessionary travel for asylum, those seeking asylum in Scotland.
And can I just ask about the older persons scheme as well, because it's been very challenging to get that age group back onto the buses post-COVID. So is it expected that there'll be less of a draw on the budget that's been allocated for that concessionary travel scheme, given predicted demand? Or are we expecting older people from 60 and over to be, increasingly getting back on the buses in the next year, and for that demand to rocket right up?
I think I'm going to hand over to Alison. I think the forecasts for the concessionary travel schemes are the same across the piece, but please, Alison, I'm just going to let you come in on that one because it's technical.
What we're seeing in terms of behaviours, in terms of the return to bus travel between the two different concessionary travel schemes, are very different behaviours. We see quite a fluctuation in the under 22 demand, dependent on time of year, etc., as you would expect. And within the older and disabled persons scheme, we are seeing less of a return to pre-pandemic demand uses. What we then do with all the information that we gather from the operators for both of those schemes is we model a range of scenarios, high, low and medium, as you would expect, of that order. And the budget reflects the position that we are most likely to anticipate to expect. As you would appreciate, however, this is a demand-led budget, so we are not entirely in control of how much of that budget is used. So that can either be a risk to the budget or in terms of an increase, or a risk to the budget in terms of it won't all be spent.
Yeah. Thanks.
Jackie, I wasn't sure if you had a follow-up on that or not.
I'm not sure. Can I come back?
Absolutely. You can come back at the end if there's a chance on that. Monica, I think you've got some questions now.
I do. Thanks, convener. I've got some questions about Strathclyde's Partnership for Transport, SPT, the Regional Transport Authority. Why has SPT's capital grant from the Scottish Government been cut to zero?
So thank you, Ms Lennon, for the question. I'm not sure whether this was something that you discussed with the Deputy First Minister last week. The convener is shaking his head at me, so I'll try and give the appraisal as I see it. The SPT general capital support allocation is funded through the local government finance settlement, and a decision was taken to pause that funding for 24-25, very much in light of the very difficult financial constraints. And I know that to the extent that that was out with my budget, I know that this was with a view to keeping it under review for future years. Now, Transport Scotland officials are in discussions with SPT about the impact of the decision and about the ability to maintain their forward investment programme. I have to say, I have great sympathy with SPT and with public bodies who, like SPT, are having to deal with funding that was expected, not guaranteed, but expected, not being forthcoming. I suppose I sympathise with that because that's what I've had to do and what the government's had to do right across the piece. You know, myself and the Transport Minister have had to prioritise projects and funds and take difficult decisions and understand the impact of that. So the discussions are ongoing. I should say that something I'm particularly keen to draw out from those discussions is the extent to which any of this, the proposed change, would impact on the provision of services. I have tried to stress through my evidence today that in very difficult financial circumstances, the continued running of the public transport network has been a priority. So those conversations are ongoing, and should it come to services being undermined, I would be open to looking again at what could be done.
Thank you. Might have time to come on to some of the impacts, but putting aside the merits of this decision, are you able to say why no advance notice was given to SPT or a request made for information on the possible impacts? You say discussions are happening now between your officials and SPT, but have a letter from the Chief Executive, Valerie Davidson. I've heard from Councillor Joe Fagan, who's the leader of South Lanarkshire Council in my area, and they seem pretty annoyed there was no upfront discussion. And we've heard about Verity House Agreement and how government wants to work collegiately with colleagues in local government and that need to work strategically and coordinate. Why has this just come out of the blue for SPT?
Ms Lennon, I was just trying to get a bit of information from my colleague there, and I might just hand to them for some of that. I would say that what has been required on the Scottish Government and of public bodies across the piece has been extraordinary when it's come to this budget. And I think the point that the Deputy First Minister has been stressing in relation to this issue, maybe not in front of your committee, was that the opportunity to use reserves in the public sector has to be an option when it comes to the scale of the problems and the challenges that we're facing. So I think that is the ask of SPT, as it has been the ask of other public bodies. To what extent do you have reserves, which of course are the public purse, which can be drawn upon, given that this is the rainy day that we have been collecting reserves for?
The committee then, you can just maybe tell us your understanding of the current level of reserves and what projects are due to be funded from those reserves.
I don't have a note of SPT's reserves.
Well, they've written to the committee and I've got a note here, but the reserves are fully allocated for projects. So maybe your official can advise about when these discussions started and what assessment was being done about potential impact. Because it sounds like assumptions may have been made that SPT could just draw down reserves. I don't know if I'm wrong in that assumption, but that's kind of how it looks.
I'll certainly hand over to my team to come in on the discussions. And for my part, I would just stress again how much I sympathise with public bodies who are having to make these considerations. And principally, I sympathise because we're having to do it ourselves. But I'll come to Alison.
So if I can just pick up on a couple of the points. So we spoke to SPT, Valerie Davidson, as soon as we were able to.
The day the budget was published, whatever day that was. So that discussion was held with the team as soon as we were able to. That's been followed up with a further discussion, which I attended in either the first or the second week back in January. It's been a long month.
You were unable, or government was unable, to speak to SPT before budget day?
So, from our perspective, the numbers were changing quite significantly across the course of the period of the budget. So, until it was settled, we weren't in a position to confirm to SPT.
This was a last-minute decision?
I wouldn't say that it was a last-minute decision. What I'm saying is that the numbers were changing across the piece. So, until the budget numbers were settled, we weren't in a place to have a fulsome conversation with them, but that we are doing that now.
And are you able to explain the rationale or methodology that brought the number down to zero?
So, principally, there are a couple of funding streams that have been in the past gone to SPT. One is around the subway modernisation, where we've got quite regular dialogue with them in terms of the profile of spend on that, profile of funding that's been made. And then the other part of it is the I think it's around £15 million, which has gone through the local government settlement part of that funding. The discussions that we've had to date have kind of shed a bit of light on what SPT had plans to spend that money on, and the discussions are now focusing on where there is an essential need to have funding to support some of that activity. The reserves did come into it. It's very clear that their accounts show that there is a reserves. The conversations that I've had with SPT to date have indicated that they had plans for those projects, for those reserves in terms of some of the projects, and that's the detail that we're exploring with them now.
Did government not already know that?
It's not really our business to know that level of detail of how SPT operates.
Well, I think it is if you're not going to give them the funds that they need. I mean, I don't know, Cabinet Secretary, you know, that's probably a point for you to address. I mean, as committee members, obviously we have a scrutiny role, but, you know, we'd like to think that behind the scenes there's good coordination and good communication with other public bodies to get that joined up approach. And after all, you have responsibility across government for the coordination of net zero. This doesn't sound like good practice to me, and I do have skin in the game, as do you, in terms of we both have parts of Lanarkshire that come under SPT, but it seems like a lot of assumptions were made and we had last minute decision making going on. So don't you think that SPT and the local authorities in that area are owed an apology?
So I would come back to that critical point that I made at the beginning about the undermining of service provision. And the conversations that Alison has referred to are about exploring that. And, you know, as I've said, to the extent that they are undermined, that's a concern of mine and something that I would look to work with SPT on. But two points just to re-emphasise. You will be tired of hearing us say this, but I cannot emphasise enough how difficult the financial circumstances have been in seeking to balance this budget. We have to use every single lever that we have to maximise the resources that we have. And of course, that includes public sector reserves. And the other contextual point I think is worth making is that this is a budget in which we have increased the local government settlement share of the discretionary budget, and we've delivered record funding of over £14 billion to local authorities to fund that council tax freeze. So none of this is easy, and conversations are ongoing. Reserves have to be considered when we are facing the financial constraints that we are. But I sympathise greatly with SPT, as I do with every public body across the piece that's having to consider efficiencies in this most difficult time.
Convener, I'm going to hand back to you, but I think it's worth noting that sympathy isn't going to get us to net zero. I asked earlier on about confidence levels and meeting the interim targets, the 2045 targets, and I'll just read out this one sentence from Valerie Davidson, the chief executive of SPT, who says, cuts to this funding will have a hugely negative impact on our efforts to ensure transport in our area is greener, more connected, more reliable and more accessible. That doesn't give me confidence, convener.
And At that moment, I fear we may come back to this later in the session when other MSPs come in, but I'm going to move on and move straight to Douglas Lumsden. I think you've got some questions.
Thanks, Convener. Cabinet Secretary, why have you chosen to allocate zero funding to the Bus Partnership Fund in 24-25? A move that the Confederation of Passenger Transport has stated could prove disastrous for the future of bus priority. It just seems strange that in a time where we're trying to encourage more people to use public transport, that we're basically cutting this budget, well, not cutting it, zeroing it.
I understand entirely the question from Mr Lumsden. I think the first point I would make is just to stress again that facing the settlement that I did, my responsibility to the transport network had to be first and foremost to keep it running, to keep services running, to keep it reliable and to keep it safe. Therefore, there is a degree of additionality when it comes to a fund like the Bus Partnership Fund, which is additional to the question of keeping your transport system running. So whilst we were able to attribute funding to very important parts of the bus network, the concessionary fares, the network support grant, the community bus fund, I was not, regrettably, not able to fund the Bus Partnership Fund in this year. That's not to say that I don't continue my support for it in future years, because I absolutely acknowledge the value of it. And I would just clarify that we will continue to fund any projects currently under construction and complete any appraisal work which could lead to the future investment. But for this year, with this settlement and principally a near 10% cut in my capital budget from the UK government, I can't afford it.
We can argue about funding, that we've seen that your overall funding, your overall budget has actually gone up. It's just, you know, back to the point you've chose where to make savings. And it's back to the point that Monica Lennon makes about, you know, if you're serious about net zero, if you're serious about climate change, then surely you have to prioritise these types of budgets at this time. And by basically putting them down to zero or cutting them, you're not really credible, are you?
As I said earlier, I think that the draft budget that I have proposed is credible in respect of climate change, and it does all the things that I set out to do: fund my legal requirements, keep our transport network running safely, and rise to the climate emergency. I haven't been able to do that in every single budget line as previously, principally because of capital cuts, and the Bus Partnership Fund, sadly for this year, is one that I won't be able to fund.
But it's not just about keeping the lights on and keeping things running. It's about making public transport better, to encourage more people to use public transport, because that will create the modal shift that we're all looking for. So surely by cutting these types of budgets, we're going to go backwards.
I wouldn't like to think we would go backwards, but I appreciate the fact that we won't get the additionality that we might have gotten from the development of the Bus Partnership Fund. But again, I look to the extent that I have been able to increase the funding for concessionary fares, that we have been able to fund the operators' predicted requirements in respect of the network support grant, that I have marginally increased the community bus fund, and I think there's real additionality there because of the opportunity that will create for local authorities to potentially create even more ways of making people take that modal shift that you talked about. I regret that the Bus Partnership Fund can't be funded this year. It is principally because of that capital issue that we're facing at the hands of the UK government. Mm-hmm.
But in terms of capital, you can, as a government, move from money from resource budget to the capital budget. So that's why when we look at the SPICE briefing, it does show that resource and capital is increased in real terms. So you could actually make that switch. You can keep the capital funding to the levels it was, or even increase it if you chose to do so.
But I suppose technically you can, but I suppose where that's been required and exercisable across the government, that will already have been done. I should point to the fact that my resource budget is extremely tight as well.
I'll move on from buses to trains, Convener. So can you give any assurance that the 10% reduction in revenue support for ScotRail and Caledonia Sleeper is not going to have any reductions in services?
Yeah.
In terms of frequency, quality and reliability?
I can assure Douglas Lumsden that that is absolutely my intention, and I think, as I've said a number of times, but I'll repeat for the record, the safe, efficient and continued running of the transport network, including our railways, has been a priority of mine. Just to give a bit of colour to some of the figures, that 10.8% reduction that Mr Lumsden is right to point to, a couple of reasons for this. Firstly, it is to an extent reflecting an increased revenue from passenger numbers recovering and a slight decrease, therefore, of the subsidy that's required for ScotRail. But this is together with a significantly reduced capital budget, which is about £90 million down, and that's for the accounting of lease arrangements following the transition of the sleeper into public ownership. So that's a technical adjustment, but it does speak to the reduction in that line. One overall figure, which I always think is very enlightening when it comes to the running of our rail services, is that we are investing, I think, £1.6 billion this year. That compares to pre-pandemic, when we were investing about £1 billion. So you can see how the costs have skyrocketed when it comes to fuel, when it comes to staff. Now, that has necessitated in many ways the rail fares increase that will come at the end of the financial year, because with that level of increased cost requirements, the safe running and the services that we currently enjoy, unfortunately, would be at risk without that increased revenue.
So in terms of investment into the rail, there was a commitment to spend £200 million to reduce the travel times between Aberdeen and the Central Belt by 2026. So far, very little of that has been spent. And when I look at the infrastructure investment plan, there's no mention of it in there either. So can you give that guarantee that journey times between Aberdeen and the Central Belt will be reduced by 20 minutes by 2026?
That is currently being reviewed, and it's something that the Transport Minister is looking at very carefully. I always like to think of this as two different projects. One is the enhancement projects by 26, as you refer to, and the other is the decarbonisation work. Now, the Transport Minister is currently considering, within the context of the funding that's available, the rail enhancements that will be able to be taken forward in the coming years. Now, she will update committee members on that. That's work that she's principally leading. For my part today, I would say two things. One, that we remain utterly committed to this work, but two, that we are constrained to an extent by that pervasive 10%, up to 10% cut in our capital budget.
That's a strange thing to say, that you are committed, but you're reviewing it. So you're either reviewing it, it's going to happen, or it's not going to happen. So can you give any assurance?
That's not quite true, unfortunately. It's just not it's not that linear when it comes to the delivery and the pace over which you deliver, the time over which you deliver a project like this. It's not just a case of you're either committed to it and it happens, or you're not committed to it. When budgets are constrained, it's only right that you consider the time over which projects can be completed. As I say, that's work the Minister for Transport is currently undertaking, and I'll ensure that she updates the committee.
It was a commitment made in 2016, so there'll be plenty of people in the North East that will be alarmed by what we've just heard. Moving on, staying on the trains, in terms of the sleeper service, that's now been in public ownership for about 7 months. Has there been any change in terms of how much it's costing the public purse, how much it's in terms of the costs for passengers, increase in passengers? Can you give any information on that?
I don't have figures on that in front of me. And again, I'm always keen to bring as much accuracy as I can to the committee. Unless my colleagues can, we might have to come back to you on that.
Sorry, Mr Lumsden, I'm not sure exactly what it is that you're looking for with that question.
Just simply, is it costing the public purse more or less? Is the passenger numbers more or less? I just want to understand what the benefits have been from moving the sleeper service into public ownership.
Okay, I suspect that that's probably something in terms of budget scrutiny it would probably be better if we wrote to.
Of the committee, that if you write to the committee on that subject, they can decide whether they want to take it further. But it would be helpful, once you've had a chance to reflect on it, all things Caledonian sleeper, so we can understand it. Bob, you want to come in?
I do, convener. So I suppose I'm trying to get a kind of baseline for what MSPs and the travelling public would consider an appropriate frequency of service to be in relation to ScotRail. I'm conscious that frequency in many routes has had to be reduced through COVID, and as numbers haven't increased to pre-COVID levels and income has fallen, that the frequency hasn't returned. So in my own local line that declare an interest I use almost on a daily basis, the Glasgow to Arnisland via Maryhill, that was a 30-minute service, but because of COVID, out with peak times now, that's an hourly service. Convener, I'm sure you'll appreciate when it's an hourly service, there's a tipping point there, because if one service is cancelled or delayed, you've got a hefty wait to your next service. So I suppose the question, Cabinet Secretary, of course I've got a local interest in that particular line, but it's that the aspiration and the commitment is, without maybe a time period for which you can actually achieve it, Cabinet Secretary, is that we return to pre-COVID frequency levels, because that's what my constituents would expect. Not right away, but they would expect that.
Thanks, Mr. Doris. I absolutely understand that. I have a number of well-used railway stations in my own constituency that are, I understand my constituents commute from back and forward to Edinburgh and Glasgow, and I know their frustrations at changes made at the pandemic levels. And I suppose anecdotally and locally, I'm seeing a return, and I understand that people will want to see that across the board. I mean, there's an extent to which this is about local services and individual services, and I can't give a sort of general comment on what is essentially will be different across different parts of the country. What I would say in terms of performance for ScotRail is that the service that we provide outperform the UK average. In 23 to 24 to date, ScotRail public performance monitor is 90.05% compared to 85.6% in the rest of the UK. And I think I remember correctly that the since we came into public ownership, the overall approval rating has already gone up a percentage point. Now, that may seem like just one percentage point, but actually it's quite a significant jump when it comes to 2 years of progress.
Convener, I wasn't maybe doing what Mr. Lumsden was doing, inquiring whether it was correct to take this into public ownership or not. I strongly support that move from the Scottish Government. I suppose what I'm getting at, Cabinet Secretary, is when this was franchised out, like for example, there was no Sunday service in the Maryhill line, but I persuaded the winners of that franchise to write into their bid for a Sunday service on the Maryhill line, so we now have that service. That's a positive thing. There was a 30-minute service written in to the franchise agreement pre-COVID, so clearly this is socially desirable to do that for a whole variety of reasons. What I'm looking to ascertain is that that desirable outcome will be returned to when finances allow. So what we don't have, because there's still a lot of people running the railways will be the same convener, even though it's transferred to public ownership, some will be sent with a spreadsheet saying, where can we make savings? We need to make sure we do things differently in the public sector and that we don't make savings on train lines where it's economically expedient but not socially desirable. So it's socially desirable to go back to pre-COVID baseline levels at some point, Cabinet Secretary, and I suppose that's what I'm trying to flush out.
No, I take that point, and apologies that my answer was more about the generality of performance. I'm going to hand over to my colleague Alison about anything she can say about either your local situation or, you know, that general pursuit of return to pre-pandemic levels. But I would just point again to that assessment that's had to be made and the objective of retaining that high-performing, safe and efficient rail network and how important, unfortunately, the rail fare increases were to that. Alison.
Just before I was Dan, the explanation, could I just make an observation? If you could keep it high level, and if it's on a specific constituency issue, you can, of course, write to Bob Doris separately if you so wish, but I'm on a broader horizon than local.
Okay, so that's a relief, actually, because I'm unable to comment on the direct services into Mr. Doris's constituency. The point I just wanted to get across, it's in our interest to maximise the use of the railway system that we have, both the tracks and the carriages. We have seen quite significant changes in the way in which our rail system is being used since the pandemic. Weekends now tend to be busier than during the week. It is therefore prudent for all of us to maximise the best use of the infrastructure that we have to best effect. So that means, in some instances, a reduction during the week between peak periods, serve frequencies, numbers of carriages, etc., and strengthening in other areas as well. So those are the kind of conversations that go on within within Transport Scotland, with ScotRail, every time that there is a timetable change, to see where we can maximise the service frequency and maximise the passenger growth demand, because that is in all of our interests. And I will write to you specifically about your constituency matter.
I generally wasn't pushing the constituency level issue. It was a helpful example. Thank you.
Sorry, I think Mark wants to come in. Okay. So on railways, and maybe you get a chance to finish that round.
I just wanted to just come back actually to the Bus Partnership Fund, because obviously it is disappointing that the fund has been paused, but my understanding is that it is a pause and the government hasn't scrapped the fund, that the intention is to bring it back when capital budgets allow. So the question really is to yourself, Cabinet Secretary, about what councils and transport authorities should be doing. The funding isn't there for this year, but should they be continuing to develop projects to allow buses priority access? And can that work continue in the next year? Because I think it's fair to say that with some of the schemes that have been put forward, we've seen quite a lot of kind of nimbyism, and that's taken a while for councils, transport authorities to kind of work through objections and that side of things, you know, to then get to a point where they can actually put in an application and they can develop a scheme.
So absolutely correct, it's a pause. And I will work as hard as I can to return sums to the fund in future years. I mentioned that we are, for this financial, we're going to continue to fund appraisal work, which, you know, could lead to those investments in the future, which I think is some of what you're talking about. And to the extent that local authorities are able to continue to do that work, of course, I would welcome that. But I understand that the fund was important to them in doing that.
Thank you, Marcus. If that's you complete, move on to the next questions, which are actually from me, Cabinet Secretary, on what appears to have become my chosen subject. So, turning to ferries, Cabinet Secretary, last week we heard there had been a reprofiling of the loans to Seamal. Now, I'm concerned, and I'd be grateful if you could clarify, the 7 lock class ferries that are due to be replaced, does that mean that the contracts which were to be awarded in this financial year won't happen, on the basis that you must have worked out that, you know, a percentage of the money is due on signing the contracts? So can you just clarify to me, all 7 contracts, if they're ready to be signed this year, for these ferries will be signed? It's a yes or no.
I can't confirm that, no. What I can confirm is that there is allowance made within the ferries budget for potential vessel contracts in 24-25, but that is always subject to procurement, always subject to relevant statutory approvals and to outline business cases, which are still being considered.
So do you know if Seamal is ready to sign the contracts on the 7 lock class ferries that we were anticipating would be signed this year? Do you know if they're ready?
I'm not in a position to confirm that today.
It seems to be odd if you can't be in a position to clarify how you can reprofile the budget, because a percentage is due on signing the contract, and I would have thought that's a large part of that contract. Alison's trying to come in if it helps, Cabinet Secretary.
Is that okay?
Yeah.
Okay, so there is funding in the budget for the small vessel replacement programme, which is the 7 loch class vessels, which is harder to say than it should be. We have received the outline business case from Seamal, and we are in the process of, at this point in time, of discussing that with ministers with a view to reaching a decision on procurement in due course.
So we haven't decided at this stage to buy them?
Well, we're working.
Or commission them?
So we have the outline business case, which supports the procurement of those vessels. We have the funding in place in the next financial year with which to start the procurement process. What I can't say to you now absolutely categorically is that the decision has been made, but I am comfortable that the timing that has been set out in various different documentations for the delivery of those vessels still remains on track.
Okay, so I've got some confidence the money's there and there's a business case being put up. I'm not so confident that it's been signed off. Maybe that will come in due course, Cabinet Secretary.
I think, Kavira, just the point is it hasn't been signed off, but very much in trade, and as you say, funding earmarked.
Okay. Now, we heard last week that there could be further cost overruns to ATA Glensanex, which has been launched, so I can call it by its name, and 802, which hasn't been launched. There may be a cost overrun there. Is that going to come out of your budget, or which budget is that going to come out of when it's announced?
There is a technical arrangement which I am going to hand over to the Interim Chief Executive of Transport Scotland to explain to the committee.
Alison, looks like you're back in the firing line.
Yeah, that's okay. So the funding for the vessels 801 and 802 at Port Glasgow are managed by DG Economy and Mr Gray, who was here last week, answering questions on that. The intention is that at the point of delivery, where the vessels are delivered to CMAL, there will be a market valuation done on the value of those vessels, and that is the basis on which the financial technicalities will be made in terms of transfer of money and payments, and the way in which that works in the world of ferries.
You've totally confused me, Alison, because the value of the ferries, we've been told, is about 70 million, and the cost so far attributed to each of them is about 170 million. So are you getting 100 million back on both ferries from Ferguson Marine?
So that would be a matter for Mr Gray and for DG Economy. From a transport budget perspective, we will pay for the value of the vessels as we receive them.
But there may be extra money, and I think there was a meeting last week of Ferguson Marine to decide whether they were going to be on time and on budget. I haven't heard the results of that yet. But if there is extra money needed for Ferguson Marine to complete the Glensanex and 802, I'm trying to work out which budget that's coming out
of. It will not be the transport budget.
Not the transport budget.
No.
So any idea where I should look?
Well, I would have anticipated that it would come from Mr Gray's budget.
Mr Gray's budget,
responsible Cabinet Secretary for
Ferguson. He was a bit iffy if that's where it was coming from, I would suggest, last week. So, anyway, Alison, I can quote you to him to say it's coming out of his budget. Just turning then to the capital budget for ports, my question is Ardross and Harbours obviously a problem area because the piers partially collapsed, and for 801 and 802, sorry, Glensanex and 802, to use the harbour, we need an LNG tank and we need an extension of the quay because it's too short. So is that all in the budget, and will it all be done during the course of this year before Glensanex comes into service?
Again, Convener, I'll make a contribution, then I might hand over to Alison again on account of the moving parts, but equally just that this is a matter principally led by the Minister for Transport on a daily basis, albeit I have overall responsibility. Now, the investment in vessels and piers line within the draft budget document, it reflects the staging, or your favourite term, the profiling of the capital that's required in any project in any financial year. The committee will know that work on the Little Minch ports is nearing completion, and the budget that I'm proposing provides for that. Likewise, there's provision for the progression of the four vessels under construction at Chemray, and some additional estimates for emerging projects such as that phase one of the small vessel replacement programme that we were just talking about. In respect of Ardrossan, there's essentially two tracks of work happening concurrently. The first one is in respect of the overall development project, which I know the committee will be very aware that the Minister for Transport had to take the decision to pause in 2023 and to relook at the business case, and the work on that has actually been expanded now. So the work has been undertaken. I appreciate the sensitivity of it, and the importance of it, and I think that's why it's important to point out it's being overseen by a ministerial task force co-chaired by the Minister for Transport. I understand the need to progress, I understand the frustration of the communities, but on the other hand, it's absolutely essential that works of this size and importance are properly scoped and properly understood. Now, we've had some additional operational matters on our Dawson in the last 10 days, couple of weeks, in respect of the Irish berth. I'm being kept regularly up to date on that, and I will make sure the Minister for Transport keeps the committee up to date. Peel Ports are using divers to explore the extent of the damage. There's work ongoing to facilitate a freight-only operation from Troon in order to try and build up some capacity there. But that's an overview of what are quite a lot of activities happening in Ardrossan just now, and if I've missed anything, my colleagues can pick up.
And I appreciate to hear all the work that's going on. I guess my question is, will the LNG tank and the pier that need to be built at Ardrossan be built in time for 801, the Glen Sannox, to appear, and is the money in the budget? That's my bottom line question.
So the plan for the operation of Glen Sannox initially, when we take kind of control of that later this year, is for it to operate from Troon, and plans are underway for that operation of those of that vessel, and most likely 802 from Troon, while works at Ardrossan are considered, as the Cabinet Secretary has outlined.
Okay, I understand that. My question is therefore, is the money in the budget to get the standard of work, the Ardrossan up to the required standard in this year's budget?
So there is sufficient funds in the budget for us to be continuing the consideration of the business case for the work at Ardrossan, which the Cabinet Secretary has already outlined.
My mouth is just sort of recovering from dropping onto the table. I can't believe we ordered these ferries in 2000 and whenever it was, 15. We knew what they were going to require. We knew they were 102 metres long. We knew they needed LNG in that day. And yet we are, wherever we are, 2004, a long way down the line, and we're still talking about a business case for the improvements to the report, to the port that's needed where they'll be using. I'm completely shell-shocked by that.
So can I come back on just a couple of points? First of all, this is a really complex engineering exercise involving multiple partners with different interests, and that has what has resulted in the need to re-evaluate the business case for Ardrossan. Similarly, we are in a completely different financial position than we were back in whenever the dates were that you've just outlined there as well. So it's beholden on us to make the right decisions for the whole of the ferry network. So while there may be ebbs and flows in where ports and harbours infrastructure improvements need to be made, it's right that we take the opportunity to spend and invest the money where we can.
OK, I hear that. Cabinet Secretary, my comment to you is simply they were to be delivered in 2017, 18, 19, 20, 21, 22, 23 and now 24, and we still haven't got the harbours ready for it, and it doesn't appear that we're in a position to have the harbours ready for it for a long time to come because we're just doing the business case. Can you see why people may be frustrated by that? Or maybe it's just me because I've been looking at ferries for 7 years and I seem to have understood the problems better than other people have, Cabinet Secretary.
No, I do understand, Convener. First of all, I mean, I would say harbour. We're talking singular here when we're talking about Ardrossan. And, you know, Alison's clarification about Glen Sannox and Troon is helpful. The only thing I can do is to, again, just never allow us to minimise the complexity of these issues. And I think the need to look again at the business case for Ardrossan and then to find when we're doing that piece of work itself needs to be expanded speaks to the complexity and speaks to the number of actors that are involved, as Alison described. But, you know, from my perspective, from a political cabinet secretary sense, I am very keen, as ever, that progress is made on all of this as quickly as possible.
Well, I hope the business case for our trust and finally lets 801 and 802 work from it, because it's been a long time coming. Anyway, Douglas, I think you've got some questions on... Yes, you've got a couple of questions.
Yes, I do have some questions. I was just going to quick follow up on that, though. So in terms of the harbour infrastructure was one thing, but in terms of the LNG infrastructure, is there anything in the budget to support LNG for the vessels once they're launched? Anywhere.
So, yes, there is money in the budget to support the LNG supply for 801 and 802 at Troon.
So the LNG tanks and things, that is all...
No, you're getting
already.
Into a level of detail now that's probably beyond me. I suspect that there are not tanks, but if you would like a fuller explanation of the way in which those vessels will be fuelled, I'd be happy to.
That would be helpful, thank you. And I'll move on to my other questions. And moving on to heat in buildings, Cabinet Secretary. So the Scottish Government estimate that £1.4 billion investment is needed in heat networks by 2027. So can you update us on the level of spending that has been awarded via the Scottish Heat Network Fund so far? And how likely do you think it is that the commitment to spend £300 million by March 2026 will be met?
Thank you for the question. I'll try and answer it in two parts. And if you just give me a second when I move to the second part to find the line in my book on the Heat Networks Fund. First of all, just for an overview of heat and buildings, I am pleased with the funding we've managed to secure in the coming, in draft in the coming year. It is £358.2 million, which essentially will allow us to maintain our schemes in the coming year. This is part of a wider commitment to spend 1.8 by the end of the Parliament and will mean that by the end of 24-25, around £1.3 billion should have been invested. And again, I stress that I'm very pleased about this because I see this as being one of the principal means by which we make progress on a heavily greenhouse gas dependent part of our economy. Now, if you just bear with me very briefly, Convener, I will find, I have a note of all my heat and buildings project lines, and I can find Scotland's Heat Network Fund. Is that the... Yes. The original commitment of £300 million to March 2026. We have £25 million drafted into the budget for the coming year. Achievements to date, we've funded... the extension to Aberdeen City Council's Tory Heat Networks, which is decarbonising homes under recovered waste heat from a new energy from waste facility. That's just an example of some of what we've done to date. I think in respect of that, the full commitment, much like a lot of the work in heat and buildings, actually, the uptake is increasing. And I expect this was always expected to be one where it would be backloaded, as it were.
On to my next question. In terms of where the demand might grow, it's obviously the deadlines passed for local authorities to publish their local heat and energy efficiency strategies. And so can you reflect on the role that these strategies will play in that heat decarbonisation? Because I would imagine they will highlight where a lot of the funding will be required.
Yeah, and again, I might come to Kirsty if she's anything to add, and you'll have to apologise. I have 10 or so individual schemes across the heat and buildings work, but my understanding of the Heat Network Fund is about offering that variety of financing mechanisms, including grants, repayable assistance and loans to provide tailored support to public and private sector organisations. So not limited, I wouldn't say, to the work of local authorities in respect of their local heat and energy efficiency strategies. But Kirsty, if I am missing the point on any of that, please do let me know.
Yep. I'll maybe add a couple of points. So just one point on your first question around progress on heat networks. So in addition to the capital spend, we work with heat network developers on pre-capital spend. So we have supported 23 capital projects on their sort of pre-investment work as part of this. So it really is progressing. It is, you know, still to some extent early days for heat networks, but provided significant amounts of support. On your second point on local heat and energy efficiency strategies, you're right, I believe it's 11 of the local authorities have finalised their heat local heat and energy efficiency strategies. We are expecting the remainder to have completed them by the end of this financial year. And they set out the areas that are looking likely and probable and beneficial for heat network development. They then work with heat network developers. And the plan is then to develop specific heat network zones at the end of that process, and that should be clear by the time we get regulations in on decarbonisation, as I'm sure we'll come to.
Okay, just for clarity then, you said 11 had been finalised, so obviously 21 haven't. Were they not all meant to be finalised by the end of the calendar year?
Yeah, no.
So they are late.
They are late, but we expect them to be finalised by the end of the financial year. So three months late.
Okay. So is there any feedback from local authorities? Why are they late? Is there do they have a problem with funding, or what's the hold up?
It's perfectly understandable that you should ask that. And it's obviously something that we keep a close eye on. The local authorities who were unable to have published by December, they cited delays in recruiting staff, the need to undertake meaningful engagement with the local community, as I think we would expect in a project like this, and the capacity of specialist consultants that they relied on to produce the strategies. So different local authorities, there's been a disparity in access and ability to manage those things. But as Kirsty says, 11 done and the rest expected in the coming months.
And can you maybe just tell us, is it rural authorities that have been struggling, or urban, or...?
Let me check that.
Okay.
Let me check. I expect it's a mix. And there are certainly some front runners. Yeah. But again, for clarity and for the precision the committee needs, I'll come back to you.
And does it ring any alarm bells that they've been late in delivering the strategy, that's going to obviously cause a knock-on effect, actually, us moving forward and decarbonising all our homes?
Well, look, I obviously would prefer that every local authority had met the deadline. But equally, I understand how all of the capacity constraints that I listed can affect projects like this, and how different local authorities have different capacities to take it on. But really, we are only talking a matter of months. As I say, I expect them all by the end of the financial year.
Okay. Thank you. Thanks, Camilla.
Ms. Lumsden, always helps if you look the other way when you want to ask a string of questions, so I can't interrupt you. We are running short of time, so I would encourage members to keep them as short as possible. But I'm going to go to the Deputy Convener, Ben.
Thank you. Just a brief supplementary. Heating our buildings in an energy efficient and environmentally friendly way is obviously one of the biggest challenges for meeting our targets. Most people in Scotland live in urban constituencies like the one I represent. And I'm pleased to see from the government, while there's a determination to move as quickly as practically possible, there is also an understanding within the consultation that's currently live that this will take time. The biggest challenge that people face in my constituency is when they live in what's called pre-1919 tenements, where general maintenance and repair is something that is difficult to action and achieve under the Tenement Scotland Act 2004. There are similar challenges in factored properties under the Property Factoring Act of 2011. There is some work that this Parliament has undertaken under the Tenement Maintenance Working Group that I initiated and has been brilliantly taken forward by Graham Simpson and colleagues in recent years. And I just want to make sure, Cabinet Secretary, that as well as the considerations that Mr. Harvey is undertaking and Mr. McLennan are undertaking, that this is also on your radar, because currently the Law Commission is undertaking a project around owners' associations, making them mandatory, and consideration of sinking funds. If we do not enable the thousands of tenement owners, of which I should declare an interest, I am one, who live in these pre-1919 tenements, we're not going to meet these targets. This law is crucial. It's hard law. It's rightly being considered in a patient way, but we need to get it right. And I just wondered if you had any comment on that.
Yeah, absolutely. I'm smiling slightly, Mr. McPherson, because I'm considering how both you and I will be drawing on our commercial legal practice and training in all of this. So, yeah, absolutely. I suppose in respect of the Heat and Buildings Programme, on the one hand, I recognise how important it is, vital, in fact, to decarbonising and how vital that mission alone is, but also, on the other hand, how it has to be realistic, it has to be affordable, it has to be pragmatic, it must be capable of reflecting the varieties of our housing stock. And tenemental properties is one very important aspect of that. So are rural properties that, you know, will require a huge amount more to make energy efficient than a relatively newer build. So I suppose I just want to give you a guarantee that despite the importance of the work, despite the fact that it has to happen across the board, I'm determined that there will be a recognition of the different challenges that we'll face across different types of housing.
Thank you.
Thanks, Ben. Monica, I think you've got a quick question followed. I think then we're going back to Ben as well. So, Monica first.
Yeah, I promise it'll be quick and straightforward. I did refer to SEPA earlier on, so I'm coming back to that. Cabinet Secretary, you referred to a small increase in SEPA's budget. How do you anticipate that will be used?
So it's a 7% increase on 23-24, and I'm pleased to note that it is an increase for the second concurrent year. I should also put on the record that as I'm stressing the increase in funding to both the environment bodies in my portfolio, I also have an expectation of public sector reform in respect of them both. And I think that SEPA's digital transformation is both a response to the need for that and also a recovery from the cyber attack. In terms of what I expect it to be used for, well, principally in relation to the two core functions of SEPA, firstly, environmental regulation, and secondly, flood risk management.
And just one final question, Convener, if you'll indulge, because that's a helpful answer, Cabinet Secretary. Do you expect to see SEPA taking more enforcement action under that banner of reform and being more agile?
I would certainly encourage agility, but whether or not to take enforcement action is a matter for SEPA and the experts there.
Okay, it's just there have been concerns that there's maybe been a lack of enforcement action, possibly due to resource and capacity functions, but is that something that you would recognise?
As with all public bodies, whilst I will not give my view on their decisions as regards enforcement, what I will do is set out my expectations for delivery. And as I say, that first and foremost role for environmental regulation and, you know, the fullest application of that is certainly, along with flood risk management, are the two priorities that I would stress.
Okay, I think it is linked to the earlier points that we discussed around polluter pays principles. I just wondered if there's opportunities coming there. Thank you, Convener.
And I think it's something we can take up with SEPA when we next meet with them. I'm going to go to Ben next for his final question.
Thank you, Convener. Just lastly, Cabinet Secretary, with regard to the circular economy that Scotland has already begun enhancing. And, of course, we have considered the Circular Economy Bill at Stage 1 over recent months. And there's been the recent publication of the Circular Economy Roadmap. I just wondered if you had any reflections at this juncture. I appreciate the government will respond to the committee's Stage 1 report in the months ahead. But I think it's important to reflect on really where is the waste in Scotland that can be tackled, whether that's in the construction sector, which is a significant aspect of our, creator of our waste as a nation, whether there were any further considerations around that the Cabinet Secretary might want to reflect on. And also, just ahead of going into the next stages of that bill, whether there's anything that you want to share with the committee.
Thank you for the open question.
I realise it was a very open question, and thank you for acknowledging it. It doesn't mean you've got an open amount of time. So I would ask you to be as focused as possible.
Well, in that vein, Convener, I suppose my reflections to date on the work of the Circular Economy Bill and the Waste Route Map, which I know you're looking very closely are on, is that it's the culmination of years of work, extensive engagement, and I think one of the most exciting, two of the exciting things that I think it's going to do is, one, look again at our targets for recycling and waste generally in the context of the climate emergency, because I'm conscious that some of our targets predate the confirmation of the emergency in around 2019. And I have lost my train of thought with what the second thing that it was going to do is, so I apologise, I should probably end it there.
Ben, do you want to push on any of that, or are you?
No, I've lost my trail of thought.
People have indicated they want questions. One is Graham Simpson and the other is Douglas Lumsden. So I'm going to go with Graham and let you ask your questions. And if you take too long, you will, of course, preclude Douglas, your colleague, from answering questions. So it's on your head, Graham.
Well, thank you very much. Well, people are falling apart around me. I'll try to do my best. I just want to go back on the issue of ferries, which you've already been asked about. Now, Ardrossan, the port at Ardrossan, I think the fact is this has been delayed because there's been no agreement with the owners of the port on who pays for what and what should be done. That's the fact, isn't it?
The number of actors involved in the complexity is one of the factors that Alison and I have both laid out, yes.
So is it the case then that we may end up in a situation where Ardrossan is not used permanently?
Absolutely no decision has been taken on that, and it would be wrong of me to preempt the work of the task force and the business case review.
No decision, therefore it's a possibility.
Where there's no decision, that's all I can say.
Okay. Now, on the small ferries replacement programme, which the convener asked about, the funding for that has been delayed. Is the reason for that delay in order to allow the Ferguson's yard to compete for that work?
I don't recognise that characterisation.
So that's a no.
Anything you want? I mean, I think we pointed earlier to the fact that delays or ensure by any other name is about ensuring that the funding is available to match the pace and the development of the project within any financial year. And I think, as Alison pointed out, we have business cases, they are being reviewed, and there's funding within the budget for when that progresses.
I'll ask you about something else now. Again, you've already been asked about this. The capital budget for SPT, which has gone down to zero. Now, that impacts on a number of projects, the subway, the central subway modernisation project. It leaves a black hole in the Lanark public transport interchange. You'll know that well, Cabinet Secretary. And an even bigger black hole, £1.8 million, in the Haremyres Park and Ride interchange, which is part of the East Kilbride Rail Enhancement Project mentioned in your major capital update, which we've just had. So these are all vital projects. And given that Alison Irvine told us earlier that the numbers were changing right up until the last minute, it sounded to me, when you set your budget, is there any possibility that the numbers could change again and that you could find some money to go towards these vital projects?
Thank you for the question. So I should just say for the first response that I discount the comment about Lanark. it's very important that I do not take decisions in my government role which have any bearing whatsoever on my constituency. So just to put that on the record. On the point about SPT, you know, I've already rehearsed the need for all public bodies to operate as efficiently as possible, and that use of reserves are part of that, and that conversations are ongoing between Transport Scotland and SPT about those reserves, what they may have been previously earmarked for, and whether that can be adjusted in light of the financial settlement. But as I say, provision of the running of our transport network has been a priority of mine, and to the extent that that appears that it could be undermined, you know, I'm committed to working with SPT on that.
No, I'm not asking about reserves. I'm asking about whether there could be extra money. Given that we've only got a draft budget, so draft budgets can change, is it your view that more money should be found between now and the point where we finalise the budget for these projects, which are actually absolutely essential if we want to get people using public transport?
Yeah, so I've already answered that question, because as I've said, it's my view, and the DFM has made this point as well, that reserves should be utilised for delivery of projects, including but not limited to some of the ones that Mr Simpson has narrated. But I reiterate, to the extent that those discussions about reserves mean that there would be an impact on the running of services, I will continue to discuss that with SPT.
OK. In the interest of time, I'll just ask you one more thing, and it's not about SPT. We've got the Fair Fares Review, which is due to see that, I think, in the next couple of weeks. Have you budgeted for any... And I'm not asking you to reveal what's in it, sure, but there might be stuff, I would hope, there's things like, you know, capping bus fares, for instance, something I've been pushing for. Is there any money in the budget for, you know, measures like that?
I think that's a perfectly reasonable question. You're right, the Transport Minister intends to publish it shortly. It's a broad document, and there are recommendations within it that will take a number of years for some of them to complete. So to the extent that budget is required this year to take them forward, that's something that I will look to provide, and there will be budget required in future years for some of the interventions, should they be agreed.
OK, that's interesting. I'll leave it there.
Thank you very much. Now, I know there's two members who want to ask questions, and because Graham was so concise in his questions, we still have run out of time. So I'm going to ask the two members if we'll submit those through a written questions to the Cabinet Secretary. I'm afraid we are out of time on this session. And I'd like to thank you, Cabinet Secretary, and your officials. I think you've been here for nearly 3 hours worth of questioning, so quite a long session. So thank you and your officials for being here, and that concludes the part of the public meeting, and we're now going to move into private session. Thank you.